You're gone. Don't call me again.
This episode deals with the inappropriateness of racial invectives and contains coarse racial slurs. Viewer discretion is advised.
Everybody loves Dynamite.
Hey, kids, can I talk to you for about 30 seconds? This is Elvis Presley. I ask you to listen. Now, here's a song.
And yes, the rumors are true. They smoke, they drink, they use bad language in mixed company. They're extremely rich, and they can flash more bling than most posses in this room. Rock stars they are, and God bless them for that.
We are basking in the glow of our incredible exposure this morning on the Fox News Channel, which I believe, since you and I were watching, Mike,
yes,
most their viewership to three.
Yes, three total viewers. And
somebody besides us had to be watching that show this morning.
Deservedly so, that they have three viewers. Because, you know, in preparation for going on the broadcast, I logged a lot of time with that show. I don't think I've ever seen anything worse on the network level.
I told you last week when I watched that it looked to me like it was directed by Charlie Stuang Stabilak.
Astounding.
Wow. Meaning that there's all kinds of weird cutaways, and they put the camera on people when the camera shouldn't be on people.
Right.
Okay, anybody that watched that, sorry about that.
Yeah, sorry. But hey, you know something? I think I said this to my wife. Even on that horrible program, I believe our segment was the best part of it.
It had to be. On our worst day, it would have been the best part
Absolutely.
Of their show. This is a morning show on the Fox News Channel that features our friend Steve Doocy, who I think is a real talented guy. And you know what? I wish that I had said on the air, but they took us off after like 2.5 minutes.
Yeah, well, it's a short segment. They have Around the Water Cooler. That's the name of the segment.
I wish I could have told him to lose the dead weight.
Yes.
That show would be good if it was like Steve Doocy for breakfast. Because you wouldn't know it to watch this show. Steve Doocy, one of the hosts, he's a real funny guy. He's a real talented guy.
He is, but it's impossible for him to say anything funny because they have, what, one, two, three, a total of four people.
Four.
And they're all on. I mean, it's not like they have their segments. They are all there sitting at the anchor desk for the entire show. Wow.
And they all talk at the same time, and the director never knows who to put the camera on since they're all talking at the same time. And a lot of times you just get a shot of someone who's just looking down at their copy.
Yeah, and they obviously are, the pressure's killing them. I mean, because they look really, to me, like they're already ready to kill each other.
And the show is so lame. They get old blue-haired ladies on the telephone who call them up, and here was the question of the day. Who's better, Elton John or Billy Joel?
I mean, you're talking about an idea that, you know, guys on college radio stations throw this idea out.
All right, so it's a bad show. We've covered that.
Okay.
Let me just bring you up to our pre-show call that we received this morning.
Oh, God, which made me laugh before we even went on the show.
About 8:15, one of their producers calls us up, right?
Oh, sucky boy kind of guy.
He's got me on one line, he's got Mike on the other line.
How you doing, fellas? Okay, yeah, yes, TV. I have a TV attitude because I'm a TV guy.
Here's what he says. He says, I'm going to run down some of the things they've been talking about on the show today. They've been talking about who's better, Billy Joel or Elton John.
Right.
They've been talking about butter. There's an inside gag on the show that he described that I didn't understand.
I didn't either. I was watching it, and I didn't understand it.
And then he says all this, and
he's like prepping us, you know, so we'll know what to talk
about. Stuff to talk about, right?
Sure.
Oh, and Yoko Ono not invited to Linda McCartney's thing yesterday, her memorial.
So he gets done going down the list, and he says, you guys all set with that? And I said, right away, I said, yeah, no problem. And then I'm waiting for Don. And
I
knew immediately,
anything.
When I hear the pause, I know immediately that you are 20 miles away, that you are not even listening to this guy.
Here's exactly
that
what
made
I,
me laugh.
Exactly what I said to the guy. Listen, we're just going to bust Steve's balls.
That's it.
So we don't even need to hear this junk. Right. And he said, okay, all right, we'll have a producer call you guys back.
And it wasn't like he was difficult about that. He said, yeah, okay, great. Okay, thanks a lot.
Now, I didn't know, because I didn't watch the show this morning before we were on, but I guess in the previous hour, that they'd had, I guess that it's the show of, it's the spark, it's a show that's in trouble. A show that's, you know, like when a muffler is dragging and hanging behind a car and all those sparks are coming up at the end?
Yeah.
When a TV show's in that situation, when they got lots of sparks, a show like Briscoe County.
Sure.
The Adventures of Briscoe County Jr. Or when it was on the skids, Babylon 5.
Babylon 5, which pulled out of its tailspin. But when they were in the severe tailspin, they too went to the radio people.
Right. That's when you know a TV show is really in dire straits. You know, 10 years ago, Hell, we would call Regis Philbin up, and he was so glad that anybody was noticing him, he would talk about us on his TV show with Kathy C.
We're here to help, you know, because we in radio, we love the Magic Box. We will always do something for the Magic Box.
So this show has hit the spark level because they got sparks coming up. Because not only are we the disc jockeys of the day, but they've had some other disc jockeys who were on in the hour previous to
us. Which made me roll my eyes when they brought in Zippy and Pinhead from Pittsburgh who did their tame segment, and I guess the lady that was one of the anchors was from Pittsburgh, and so she was saying, oh, these guys are so funny, and I immediately want to run, you know, I want to run out of the house and say I don't want to do it now, because as soon as other disc jockeys are involved,
what did they ask the other disc jockeys about? All the lame topics they wanted to talk about with us,
and you know, it was a little reminiscing about the anchor lady in Pittsburgh. Hey, we loved you when you were here. It was fantastic. Yeah. Remember the pajama party? And they show this publicity picture, and believe me, the good judgment that we showed in not sending along a publicity photo.
You know, but they didn't use the photo of the male models that we sent them.
Right. The one guy from Pittsburgh, they showed him the publicity photo. He looked like a smaller version of the lead singer from Boston. You know that hair?
Oh,
you know
the hair? Schultz with the big, bushy afro?
Absolutely. Yeah, and the beard, and I was very glad that we didn't have a publicity photo up there.
So the show's pretty bad, and they have lame topics and really no direction on this show whatsoever, and they shift topics at a moment's notice. Like, they're all just sitting around laughing about baseball and they're goofing on the sports guy, and then they go killer tornadoes in Florida.
Yeah, and they get real serious about the forest fires as they go down there, and
the forest fires.
And they have another Slicky Boy reporter, and it really is just it's uncomfortable. I realize one thing. TV, you can't do what we do here. You just can't do it on TV.
Sure you can, but you and me are the guys that have to do it.
Yeah. We have to do it, but I need to watch my TV shows. I need to know that there's some kind of structure there, or I'm going to be very uncomfortable. And I was just, my flesh was crawling watching this TV show because no structure.
How come we were on that show today, yet I sat by the telephone all day staring at it, waiting for someone at Fox News Channel to call and ask you and I to replace those hosts?
I know.
Based on our 2-minute, 36-second appearance on their show.
I thought we handled it very well.
All right, tape ready, Rob?
Yeah, tape one.
All right, tape one. Here we go.
Good.
Here's where they're talking about us. And we were telephone guests on the show.
Yes. Okay.
No picture phones.
No.
Also, in
got the dirt.
This big program, Don and Mike, who are down at WJFK, I actually know these guys.
Mm-hmm. So are they going to dish
dirt
on you?
I'm hoping they've forgotten. So anyway, they'll be with us. Plus, we're going to include your phone calls, and it's T-shirt Tuesday. Where's the T-shirt?
All right. Rob, you should have left more so we could show how lame the show is. I don't know which show would be funner to pick on, if it would be Magic Johnson or this show.
That's I'll tell you something. At least Magic Johnson. No, I'm not going to say anything nice about the Magic Johnson show.
All right, and before we run this, I would like to say that I believe that since they were operating on no delay, and I checked on that before we went on the air.
Right.
There was a brief 1-second delay for Mike and myself, but they had no
satellite.
Right. They had no on-air delay.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that they clipped us.
Yeah.
Because I said GD.
Yeah, but it got on. It got on, which I'm delighted about.
And the reason I think that they clipped us is when they came back, they made up some story about why it appeared they cut us off.
Yeah, really?
Okay. Wow. All right, so here we are now on Fox News Channel.
Welcome back. Time now to check into two today's water cooler stories. You know, the ones you will be talking about all day long. Joining us now on the phone from Washington, D.C. are my old pals Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara from the Don and Mike Show, heard on WJFK and 60 other radio stations coast to coast. Good morning, Don and Mike.
Steve, now, is this show that I've been watching, is this actually on the air, or is this just a test feed today?
This is it's a closed-circuit thing. We're just sending it out to the cable.
My God, this is the Today Show in need of Ritalin. What's going on? Steve, buddy, look at what kind of a delay are we on now? Is this like a 1-second delay?
Can we say dirty words?
There is no delay, so don't say anything.
I think it's just the satellite skip.
Man, good morning, America, with attention deficit disorder.
All right, and they're peppering this like with bad sound effects.
Oh, dear.
And when we really get into it later, which in this case will be about 30 seconds, since they didn't have us on very long.
Right.
While we are goofing on our friend Steve Ducey, the director, instead of staying with Steve Ducey, the guy we're talking about, he goes to shots of the other three anchors, and they have bemused look on their face, or they've got that look like, ooh,
what are they talking about?
I mean, it was just as phony and jiving plastic TV as you could ever imagine.
Yeah, and, you know, and everybody's out of control on this show. All the anchors are out of control, and obviously from that sound effect, whoever's running the audio, yeah, he's out of control. Everybody's just doing whatever the hell they want. It's pretty unique.
Back it up just a little, Rob, so we can hear the sound effect again.
Pretty unique in a really bad way.
Oh. Yeah. In a Magic Johnson way.
That's right.
So don't say anything.
I think it's just the satellite skip.
Man, good morning, America, with attention deficit disorder.
Is that you guys?
No, that is, I believe, that's added by someone there on your end. That's clever. That's sound effects. Very good.
We've got Bill O'Reilly. He comes in early, and he adds laughter.
Now, Steve, listen. You know, they gave us, when we were talking to your screener, whoever it is, they gave us a whole bunch of topics that you guys wanted to talk about.
Yeah, butter shortage, Yoko Ono, stuff like that.
No, Steve, let's talk about you, buddy.
Let's talk about your career, Steve.
What happened?
We want to focus on your career.
Oh, what happened to the kids show?
Oh, I left that.
What kids show?
Actually, you know what? I used to do a kids show for Fox on Saturdays.
You're good with kids, Steve. It's your boyish good looks. That's what does it.
Thank you very much.
You remind me a lot of Dave Thomas. You ever seen those Wendy's ads where Dave Thomas is driving around for some reason with, like, six or eight young boys in his car?
Hey, how you doing, kids? Come on in. How about a Biggie Fries? Have a Biggie Fries and a Frosty. Hop in the back of my...
All right, now, they're laughing.
Yeah.
But it's that... phony, like, uh-oh, I realize that these guys are saying something. yeah, ha, 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 very funny.
Yes, they're realizing what they have now, and they're terrified.
Bird. Hey, you know what's great about this is watching, because, Steve, you're laughing, but all the other people that they put the camera on, they have those awkward looks on their face.
Like, what the hell have we gotten into? Who are these guys? You know, I think we haven't said anything really bad yet, and I think
there's
the sports guy. Yeah, you know, and there's this little delay. Is he talking? There he is. Yes, he's talking now.
We should point out, you guys are on the radio in the afternoon, so are you at your own homes, or do you guys live together now?
I'm in my underwear right now. I'm actually sitting here. I've had my 3-year-old, my 1-year-old put down in the basement, and I'm in my underwear right now.
And Steve, I'm with my mistress right now.
So also true.
Shout out to my family that are watching at home.
Wait till the family is watching at home.
I guess they didn't get the male model pictures we sent them for our publicity photo. I thought we were supposed to see those on the TV. We didn't send our own pictures.
Do we have a picture of Don and Mike?
No, that was our big goof, Steve, that... We sent fake pictures, and we thought you guys would put them up, but I guess
we got them out of Glamour magazine.
Well, you know what?
No way, mister!
We could probably find a shot of somebody in the pit. Here.
All right, now he picks up a copy of USA Today that has a picture of big fat Tommy Lasorda and the new manager of the Dodgers. I thought he was on SlimFest, Tommy Lasorda.
He doesn't look good.
What happened to that?
That's Tommy Lasorda. Is that Bill Russell, the guy he fired?
No, that's, yes, it is, Mike. That's the ex-manager.
Yep.
The guy that he canned.
That, you know, that's like the first thing that Steve Doocy finds. He picks up and says, here's a picture of you guys.
Yeah, right. Lame.
Oh, lame.
So lame.
I've got a shot of Don and Mike right here.
Wait. You all have...
There we are.
Bill Russell and Tommy Lasorda.
That would be me on the left there, Steve.
And that's me on the right, Steve. I've aged since you've seen me. I've been eating a lot of bad food. I'm really upset about that butter shortage.
And I want to tell you something else. Both Elton John and Billy Joel cannot suck them up. Elton John is good for playing a concert for dead people. That's about it.
Oh,
why is he taking so much time? It looks shocking. He's taking so much time asking...
You're right. I say that, and they all go,
yeah.
I can't believe you. You should see their wide open mouths.
You know, the only thing that was great about it, isn't it a dream come true, though? Being in your home, watching the Magic Box, and just casually being on the phone, and then watching the
yeah.
That, to me, was the absolute best.
Yeah, there was something great about it. You're
absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
Suck them up. Elton John is good for playing a concert for dead people. That's about it.
Why
is he taking so much time? It looks shocking. He's taking so much time asking people this inane question about who they like better, Billy Joel or Elton John.
And the holiday of the day, come on. Yeah, drink the coffee. The holiday of the day. Get in there, prepare. Come in early, 3 a.m. Go ahead. Go for it.
We did. That was
you actually came in and prepared. That's terrible.
Yeah.
That is truly terrible.
When do you decide if we're having people back? Is that now?
Like now.
Yeah. When do we take a vote?
Yeah, right. They decided they want to have us back. Hey, it's not our fault. You suck so bad. You know what I mean? You might not think this, but we have some integrity, too.
We would have talked about their topics, but, I mean, it was more fun to talk about their show, which really, I've never seen anything like it. That's the nicest thing I can say about it. I have never seen anything like it.
And what can we possibly say about their topics?
They have butter shortage. They have
Yoko Ono
and the who's better, Billy Joel or Elton John.
Those topics suck. I don't want to be attached to those. I don't want our show to be attached to those topics.
Here, Bully.
Like Weasel and Dweezel or whoever the other Heckle and Jekyll DJs were. All right. It's almost over. Back to the interview.
You actually came in and prepared. That's terrible.
Yeah.
That is truly terrible.
When do you decide if we're having people back? Is that now?
Now.
We take a vote? Take a flip.
If you haven't talked in like 20 minutes.
That's okay.
He's a friend of yours, Steve? He's a friend of yours.
I just want to say, nobody handles the awkward moments of silence better than you guys do, though. You do a terrific job.
Thank you very much.
Let him sit there.
Hey, did you guys see this? Macaulay Culkin got married over the weekend.
That's the same thing you asked the other disc jockey. See, he's prepared.
When in doubt, whip this out.
No.
All right, let's hear that tape of Steve when he was on your show.
Oh, okay.
You have it?
They're so prepared.
I like dreaming, because dreaming can make you mine.
Hi, this is Steve Doocy from Fox TV's Not Just News show, and I never listen to Don and Mike on WJFK because it doesn't pay enough.
It's a tearful moment on the program. Steve, I like dreaming, too.
Thank you very much. That was delightful. I used to work down in Washington at NBC, the NBC station.
We miss you, Steve. We truly miss you.
Steve, do all the people know about your career? Do they know that you started off being the guy that would be like on the street when they had a big Powerball lottery thing?
You'd be the guy
that'd be out at the liquor store talking to all the people who are spending their last couple of dollars for lottery tickets.
Right.
And Steve, do they know about that incident at the health spa with the barbells? Do they know about that?
And do they know that seriously that you were like the next David Letterman, that they handpicked you and they gave you a daytime show, but then they found out you were a bit too caustic for blue-haired ladies during the day?
We want you to know, Steve, we are rooting for you, man. We are pulling for you. There's not a day that goes by where we don't want to see you succeed, baby.
So we're not going to talk about butter?
We're out of time. Hey, Don and Mike, thank you very much.
Hey, God damn it, you're taking us off?
I'd like to have you back, but I think you're not going to...
God damn it. It got on there. Wow. Oh, that's great.
Let me hear the end of that again.
Good timing.
They're
playing us out.
Oh, boy.
There's not a day that goes by where we don't want to see you succeed, baby.
So we're not going to talk about butter?
We're out of time. Hey, Don and Mike, thank you very much.
Hey, God damn it, you're taking us off?
I'd like to have you back, but I think you're not going to...
And what's this? That thing that says this is Fox News?
The Fox News Network apologizes for the previous segment.
Oh, boy. This was the commercial that they ran right after they cut us off.
This is music with a message.
It's an album full of songs about Jesus, the J-Man.
That's a happy sponsor right there.
The ultimate new collection of contemporary Christian...
All right, fast forward past the commercial, Rob. And then here's what they say when they come back from the commercial.
Mm-hmm. Oh, about the cutoff, you mean?
Yeah. Where he's going to say that they didn't really cut us off.
Ah.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, by the way, we should point out that when Don and Mike from WJFK and much of the world were with us just a couple of minutes ago, we had to say goodbye real fast. That's because we have got the very latest in digital equipment, and they run commercials at a certain time, whether we're through talking or not. So
right. Sometimes
that's why we got a little cut off. Sorry. Anyway, it was delightful to have them with us.
Right, Steve.
Steve, thanks. Right, Stever.
Steverino.
Leave it to Stever. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Come back to Florida, boss.
Listen, you are on probation.
Oh. Yeah, don't call anymore.
Come on. Hello, Don and Mike show. Pilar. Call Buzz in the office. Be one of Buzz's news cub reporters.
There you go.
Best news tip of the week. Gets what, Buzz?
$1.06.
Hello? See, we're 106 FM. Hello? Wow, this was supposed to be a guy who actually watched the show and was on hold. I wonder what happened to him.
He was the one. He was the one who actually saw the show.
It's too bad. Maybe
a hard show to find, that's for sure.
Maybe that phone line is just malfunctioning. Because the guy says he was waiting on hold, and he was going to start goofing on them.
Oh.
He told them he wanted to talk about butter. Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don.
Yeah.
Turn your radio down, please.
I don't know how to work on the radio.
Okay.
All right, thanks. Hi.
Oops.
Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hi.
Hey.
Don?
Yeah.
What is Don and Mike there?
You the same guy?
Oh, same. No, what's that?
No, it's a different guy, Mike.
Guy.
It's a different guy.
Twins.
Guy.
Hello.
Hello.
Turn your radio down,
please.
Okay. What do those guys over at Fox expect? I mean, come on.
All right, astute comment. I'm really glad I waited for that. Thank you very much, idiot. Excuse me, Mr. Idiot.
That's right.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Thanks for being on the show, Mr. Idiot. Hello. I mean, jackass.
Don and Mike.
Hey, Don and Mike.
Hi there.
How you doing? Wonderful Friday. Tuesday afternoon. Hey, where's my prize? Charlie said Ken Stevens hadn't signed the check, and it's late. It's been 3 weeks now.
You'll get it Friday.
Friday.
Mm-hmm.
Right. What is he talking about? Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hello, Don.
Yes, I am. Hello.
How does it feel to know that you are a member of a country that is second rate in anything to Iran?
I covered that yesterday on the show.
You're second rate to Iran.
Oh, listen, come on. Soccer don't mean dick. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, Don, Mike.
Yeah.
Hey, I got to tell you something. For the first time in my life, I watched the Magic Show last night.
Mm.
And, Don, you got the impression down perfectly.
Oh, no, that's Mike that does that impression.
Oh, sorry, Mike. When he started laughing, I just died. I just couldn't stop laughing. I was in the floor laughing.
All right, listen, as we continue to chart the progress of Magic Johnson's show as it spirals towards cancellation, and remember,
Howie Mandel was on.
Remember, the sign of a show going downhill is they've already gone through all of the major stars that have committed to be on the show.
Right. Yeah, who's going to be on it tonight?
Tonight, the lead guest is Jasmine Guy.
Oh, there you go.
Okay,
that's right.
Yeah, you're looking too good, Jasmine. Jasmine. You know, I see you and I just go, yeah.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Ah, you know, it's a problem with that line.
Yeah, is that what it is?
Picked out the line. It's line number three. Hello, Don and Mike.
And tell the hundreds of thousands of people that watch the Fox News Network.
Yeah. Well, I think at least one person out there might have seen it. That's what I'm shooting for here. Hello.
Hey,
well, besides you, Rob, you had to watch it. Hello.
Hey, I saw y'all this morning. I was flipping the channels.
Yeah.
And sure enough, I saw y'all, Don and Mike, so usually I just keep on going, but I said, hey, that's y'all, so I stopped.
So I took the butcher knife and I put it up to her neck, and I said, you better start flipping them channels.
Cletus, stop.
Look who's here.
Like that,
it's Mr. Clean.
All right. Well, thank you, Cletus.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right.
Bye-bye.
You know, I'm getting the impression that the bastions of viewership for this show are in very odd places, because they got lots of calls from Montana today, which was kind
of
weird.
I think it's like if you live in the middle of nowhere and they compensate by giving you every possible cable channel.
Yep, that's right. Yeah.
It's like, hey, you poor schmuck, you're living in South Dakota. Here you go. Here's seven channels of HBO to make your dreary life just a little bit better.
Congratulations.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hi, is Buzz in?
Yes, yeah. Buzz is here, yes.
Hi, Buzz.
Hi.
Buzz?
Yes, sir.
I'm very, very sick.
Okay. Thanks
all
for
right,
sharing
can
that.
You please limit your Buzz crank calls to his Saturday morning show, Capital Critters?
Yeah, it's Sunday nights.
And Sunday nights and the Washington Gang.
Washington
the
Weekly.
D.C. Follies.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hell, you're not.
But this is a guy, it sounds like he's got made-up Major Bill Smith tapes.
Ha, huh, sweetheart.
See, it's a guy doing an impression of Major Bill Smith, right?
I'm very, very sick.
Okay. All right. God. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
Is Steve gay?
Steve Doocy? No, he's married to a beautiful gal.
And he's got a couple of kids.
He just sounded like it.
Hmm. He kind of looks like it.
I guess that's just...
But he's not.
Everything's...
Let me put it this way. He wouldn't last very long in prison.
Hello. Not on my show.
Oh, dear.
Oh, come on. Oh, you know, the same people call all the time.
I have really got to stop laughing at that because that encourages that person. There's just something about that agonized cat that makes me laugh.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hi.
Hi.
I don't know, my big toe. How could that be?
All right, listen, I'm going to ignore that caller also.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you that on today's show, Dennis Murphy is coming by for his big...
A flea on my toe.
La, 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 la,
la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la, la
today. Dennis Murphy is coming by.
Yeah.
See, he hung up.
Yeah, no, so that's good. Ignore him and he'll hang up.
La, 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 la. Dennis is coming by for the big Viagra experiment.
Right.
We have the stuff. We have the porno. We have the VCR.
Mm-hmm.
We have the room with blinds. Mm-hmm. And we have a phone for Lewis. Lewis, the intern, who will be in a locked room with Dennis Murphy. And we've decided rather than subject Lewis to an hour of watching Dennis nude.
Mm-hmm. Watching a porno movie. Yeah.
We're going to only make him watch for 30 minutes.
Ah, very good. Good.
However, we are also going to strap Dennis's arms to his side.
That's a good idea. Okay, so is... Oh, I don't even want to think about that.
Right.
So, yeah, so Dennis, there will be no extraneous movement.
Yeah, so the level of Dennis's enjoyment of the movie will be accurately tracked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that there can be no...
No touching.
Assistance.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's
there
right.
You go.
No touchy-feely. Okay.
I'm guessing with Dennis, that's a pretty good move, strapping his arms down.
I think so.
Hello?
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, I wanted to... Wait, first let me say, bueno arbusta.
Right, nice boost. And Dennis, I think, is coming in very soon, like within a half hour, to start the experiment.
And happy late birthday to Mike.
Thank you. Oh, and we also have the couple coming in today, man and a woman, mm-hmm. looking to do the lesbian experiment up in the office. So any of you hot lesbians that would like to break another sister into the world of lesbianism.
She's a Reba McEntire lookalike.
That's right. Settle down, boys.
I wanted to ask you guys.
So come on down. That's the message on that. Come on down. Yeah.
What? For me to join?
No. For any prospective lesbians.
Oh, okay.
Because they're going to be here. The couple will be here at some point during today's show.
I wanted to ask you guys, if you've heard that radio commercial from Corn Nuts. You know the term, how people used to say bust a nut, right?
Sure.
You know, when you're with your chick. Yeah, you bust a nut, man.
When you're with your chick.
Yeah, well, you know what I mean.
When you're with your chick at your pad.
Yeah.
You bust your nut? Oh, yeah.
Anyway, the commercial goes like this. The new Corn Nut slogan is bust a nut, bust a nut. And at the end it goes, go bust a nut at a convenience store near you.
Really? If that's true, that's funny.
That's funny.
Hello, Dynamite.
Hey, guys.
I've
got to hear that commercial now.
Hello. At a convenience store. Really?
At a convenience store near you.
Hello.
Don?
Yeah, I am. Hi.
Hi. Hey. I want you to send me out with the fairy godmother. I haven't heard her in a long time.
Right. Well, our animal listeners have been very well behaved recently.
Oh, yeah.
She hasn't come out of her little Swiss chalet cuckoo clock.
Listen, trust me. You got to have the fairy godmother in small doses. If she was here all the time, you'd get real sick of her.
Okay.
So hey, she only comes out for those real problem callers.
Mm-hmm. And Buzz, why is that she only comes out once in a while?
Well, she's firm, but fair.
Hello. And foxy.
Oh,
three F's.
Yeah.
Firm, fair, foxy.
Oh.
Yeah. And the fourth F that I can't say on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
What's that fourth F?
Effable. Hello.
Firm, fair, foxy, and effable.
Don't forget about the five F's. Find them, feel them. I guess that's the four F's. Find them, feel them, F them, forget them.
That's a back. That's another one back. Great one back from grade school. Then.
Leave it to Beaver. Hello.
Hey, just wondering if I can get that a special number to your office.
1-800 ask for ass. And your radio's up too loud.
He turned it up after he said his little ditty.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, you guys are on national TV today. Probably a good thing you're on the phone, because I bet you both were crapping your pants.
This is the original crap your pants guy?
Oh, yeah. I saw you guys crapping your pants.
Yeah, I guess you are. Okay.
Well, what's wrong with me, huh?
Well, nothing. It's just you're coming on the heels of a bunch of other callers who want to be regular callers who really haven't earned their merit yet.
Well, I got another regular caller sitting right here by me.
You
hey,
do?
Come here.
Who's that?
Hey, it's Bob Dole.
Is this really the Bob Dole guy?
He's Bob Dole.
I think I said that the crap your pants guy might have been the Bob Dole guy. But I mean, the Bob Dole, the crap your pants guy doesn't sound like the original crap your pants guy.
No, it's because this guy's on a different sounding phone, I think, today.
Are you on a different phone?
You're damn right.
All right, let me hear you say crap your pants.
Just a second, let me get the phone to him. Crap in your pants.
Yeah, that sounds like it.
And now let me hear Bob Dole.
Just a second. I mean, Bob Dole. Kind of screwed up there. Bob Dole's a little...
All right, listen.
I
throw a shout-out your way. Shout, shout, shout. Because at least you've come up with something new, Bob Dole guy.
Thank you.
All right. Goodbye now.
Bob Dole.
Bob Dole. Bye-bye. See you later.
Bye-bye.
There he goes. We got to do a quick break, and then we're coming right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. And now, live from Washington, D.C., here's Larry.
My guest is Robert Daly. His newest book is A Faint Cold Fear. It is published by Little Brown. We'll be going to your calls at the bottom of the hour at 703-685-2177. Are you already working on the next one?
Well, I know pretty well what I want to do, and there's a long process to go through. I have to write an outline, and although I have a contract with the publisher, they have the right to, you know, diddle with my outline, which they always do. And I have to work out the details and then start it and then write it. And so we're talking about another year here. And the end of the year gets very long because whatever you may have done, I mean, you've written enough books to know this, until you write the end, at the end of it, you got nothing. Even, you know, you can't sell anything until you finish the last page.
Who's your agent?
Huh?
Who's your agent?
ICM, Esther Newberg.
I know Esther.
Lovely woman.
I use Sterling Lord.
Oh, you do? Sterling was my agent for years and years and years.
I like him. He's not vigorous.
No.
But he has a kind of nice manner.
Yeah.
I think if I were a full-time writer, I don't think I'd use Sterling. I like someone more.
Yeah.
For me, it's fine. You know, I get these. Well, I just got a real nice advance to do a book on growing up in Brooklyn. Mm. Like Russell Baker did about Baltimore, right? About just what the street was like in the neighborhood.
Well, you got four books already behind you.
Yeah. Yours on the bestseller list yet?
It's not yet. It's only been out 1 month, and the bestseller list is 2 weeks behind, as you know. But it's had wonderful sales in Europe. I'm really astonished.
Same cover?
I don't know. I don't know what they'll do. I don't like the cover. It's got two messages. Yeah, it's okay. It's got two messages on it, both of which are, you know, sort of against the female.
Can't read this.
In New York, but I really live mostly in Connecticut, in New Canaan.
East side?
West side, right opposite the Museum of Natural History.
Nice, I like this.
Yeah.
It's really growing, that area.
Uh-huh.
Columbus.
Yeah. Lots of empty stores, you know. And these landlords who jack up the rents and force people out that have been there for years. Now, in our times, in the recession, they're stuck with it. Good.
Damn right. I thought we were on a break. Okay, so we've been sitting here all the time, talking and not talking. Does anybody signal me? Are we on a break? Did we take a break? No, we're back. Well, you never signal me back from a break. Are we on? Okay, thanks. Did anyone ever say, here's Larry? Did you hear it, Robert?
No, I did not.
Robert didn't hear it, and I didn't hear it. I'm just talking to the crew. I realized we're on. I looked up. I saw the light. Neither of us ever heard a signal come back. So we have been sitting here. Welcome to the Larry King Show. Our guest is Robert Daly. We're going to pause for news headlines, a word from your local stations, and when we come back, we will take your phone calls. Our numbers are 703-685-2177, and this is semi-hysterical. Yeah, we are on. Thank you. Okay, all I'm telling you is, Mr. Daly and I were sitting here. The last I remember was breaking for commercial, and we never came back. So if we came back, we thank you. And if you heard us talking, I don't know what we were talking about, Robert.
We're talking about agents and things like that.
Agents.
Can't be much interest to...
Couldn't have been... If you heard whatever you heard, we didn't curse.
The Don and Mike Show.
The boy was wearing a Hawaiian shirt.
So?
There's only two kinds of guys who wear those shirts. Gay guys and big fat party animals. And Bart doesn't look like a big fat party animal to me.
So if you wore a Hawaiian shirt, it wouldn't be gay.
Right.
What's up, Doc? How you doing? The Don and Mike Show.
I'm not trying to turn this show into bash the manager every day, but I can't help it that every day another manager that we work with here does something that's just totally two-faced.
It's happened to you again. This has been a bad week for that.
All right, now this one's not with Ken Stevens.
No.
Okay, because I documented our problems with Ken Stevens earlier in the week.
And you even had contact with Ken today and everything was fine, right?
The guy's so anti-confrontational.
Yes.
Okay? That after all the stuff that went on the air earlier this week about him,
mm-hmm.
he calls up today about an unrelated item and acts like it never happened. He goes, hey, how you doing? Listen, I got a question for you, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, okay, you know, waiting for him to say, listen, I'm mad about the other day when
right.
you called me the world's biggest pussy and everything. Mm-hmm. He is the world's biggest pussy because he didn't say anything about it. He said, well, okay, everything's good on my end.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, have a great weekend.
Doesn't he know that he could make you happier if he gave you one good, solid confrontation a week?
Well, you know, at least when they're needed, when they're necessary.
When they're needed, when they're necessary. I'm not talking about phony manufactured like Seinfeld hype manufactured. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about you'd be happier with one, maybe a year, one good, solid one a year where he screamed and you screamed.
Have we ever heard him scream other than the I'm not tape?
Oh, yeah. No, he screamed at us before.
Oh, okay.
He screamed at us before.
Mm-hmm.
But things are going too good right now.
Yeah.
Things are going very well.
He just likes putting his head in the sand. But he's not the problem today.
You got another one? There's another one on the list today?
Yeah, the pretty boy.
Okay.
Jeremy Coleman.
Oh, man, B-Day man.
Okay. I've been working behind the scenes for about 2.5 months
right.
with a bunch of people on a project that we hope to be presenting to everybody, hopefully by now, but very soon in the near future.
It's something we're very excited about.
It's mm-hmm. a new big pay-per-view.
Oh, okay? Excellent.
Something that's never been seen before. It's a totally live pay-per-view. And I'm working on it, and unfortunately, Jeremy is the guy who's representing our company, CBS, in this venture.
Well, there's a problem right there.
So he's the point man,
yeah.
Okay? So I had a meeting with him last week, and he said we couldn't do it unless we did it like this. And I said, well, okay, how about if we do it like this, give him another option? And he said, okay, that's great. We'll do that.
Right.
Then let's see. Today's Thursday. So on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, every day, I said to him, hey, let's talk about the pay-per-view.
Mm-hmm.
And every day he put me off. And yesterday when he put me off, I was coming around the corner during the show because he goes to lunch from 2 to 3 every day.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Oh, okay.
Conveniently, because that's when I'm always in the office.
Ah. Right.
So he can always walk in the door at 10 after 3 and go, hey, I just missed you. I was out to lunch.
Sure.
So yesterday I'm coming back from the John. I come around the corner. And he's talking to you, Buzz.
Yeah.
He's talking about that little problem you have with the commercial. If you should do the... That's not a secret, right?
Well, I guess not now.
Because everybody knows.
Yeah.
You know, listen, and my advice on that...
Uh-huh.
Do the commercial.
Good. That's what I'm going to do.
What do you care? You're so sensitive, Buzz.
Yeah.
What's it a commercial for?
It's for a skincare product.
Come on, be more specific.
What type of a skincare?
Lavoris and all the other fine products. No, it's for people who have seborrhea and psoriasis.
Oh, I had a cat one time that had seborrhea. Oh,
wow.
Yeah.
My Uncle Jack had that.
Seborrhea or
no,
psoriasis?
Mm-hmm.
Psoriasis.
Well, psoriasis, different things.
Well, maybe he didn't have it.
Auntie Lola had cirrhosis, didn't she?
What is cirrhosis?
That's your liver.
Yeah.
That was Auntie Lola. And yeah. Uncle Jack, too.
And it had cirrhosis?
Yeah. Yeah, both of them heavy drinkers.
Didn't we have some, didn't Scatter, the monkey, have cirrhosis of the liver, too?
Yes, that's what we heard the other day.
They fed it booze all the time.
And I believe Rudy Martsky is currently suffering from that condition, based on his appearance yesterday's show.
Since he was 25.
All right, so Buzz has been going through this whole behind-the-scenes thing. Just let me tell you something, okay? This man changed when he got a parking spot. That's all I want to say.
Stop it.
That's all I want to say is that he was very quiet.
He had gone to his head.
Very quiet, very unassuming. I remember the quote. He said it on the air a couple of weeks ago. Hey, I promised myself I wouldn't be a jerk when I got my parking spot.
Right.
But now I'm going to have a fit.
No.
No, it's been a couple of things, but
yeah.
So you were having a meeting with Jeremy yesterday.
Yeah, and he was
simply asking his advice.
He's discussing this matter, right? And I walked around, and I didn't butt in on your meeting. I just said, hey, Jeremy, and maybe you were even there, you heard this. I said, let's talk tomorrow about PPV.
You did, and he agreed.
And he said, pay-per-view, yes. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, tomorrow. I said, do you promise? And he said, yes. And he even pointed at
me. You looked him directly in the eye yesterday, and you said to him,
tomorrow.
Do you promise?
Yeah.
And so you followed up the conversation with
him. Here's my witness right here, Guy Burbank.
So it's like a big deal that you know, he'd been blown off a lot before, and he wanted to make sure that the meeting was today.
Jeremy seemed clear on it and agreed to the meeting.
Okay. So I come in today, and I go back by his office, and he's got a letter on the door. And it's typed, you know, with his little itsy-bitsy handwriting, and it says, hello to everyone. Out of town Thursday and Friday. Jer, J-E-R. Right? So I go, huh.
He shouldn't be allowed to slide like that. That's not fair.
Just wait, though. I said, I wonder where he could be. So I went and asked a couple people around the station.
Mm-hmm.
Well, as it turns out, he's in Jamaica, man.
Jamaica for Jeremy to be there, man. On his big old feet there, having a vacation, man.
And we got the phone number. Let's call that little weasel up right now.
That's right. Let's call the drum man out there with his skinny little white body on the beaches of Jamaica, man.
Everybody follow my drift here that he, of course, yesterday knew that he would be leaving today to go to Jamaica.
So unlike other people that have to let people know in advance.
Hello?
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 Yeah.
Yes, hello. This is Don and Mike. We're calling from America, the greatest nation in the free world. We're doing a radio show right now, a very important radio show. And we would like to speak to Master Jeremy Coleman, please.
Master Jeremy Coleman?
Yes.
Yes, Jeremy Coleman, C-O-L-E-M-A-N.
Right. He's staying here?
Yes, he's staying there.
Yaman. Iriman.
That's right. Big Jamaican vacation.
How's the weather in Jamaica today?
It's pretty hot.
Very, very hot.
You know, he could have just said to me yesterday, hey, listen, I'm going out of town.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about it when I get back.
Couldn't do that. That would have been too honest.
He's a graduate of the Ken Stevens School.
Yes, that would have precipitated a confrontation.
Right.
Hello, just hold a moment, please.
Okay, thank you.
Great.
Oh, here we go.
He wouldn't be out by the pool.
No way.
He'll burn up like a chip in a fryer. You know, you put him up and it was just like, hello.
He's so frail.
Hello.
Oh, they haven't picked up. I thought I heard a, hello. There we go.
Oh, there it is. It's those weird Jamaican telephone rings. Maybe he's on the bidet.
Jeremy's just like covered with sunscreen. You know that stuff you put on your nose? Only he's got it all over his body with one of those big drinks with an umbrella.
Well, I bet he's at one of those all-inclusive places, so we'll just have the call switched out to the bar.
Bar.
Like he'd be at the bar having a glass of milk.
What the hell would he do? He's the type of guy that shouldn't take a vacation. I don't picture him doing anything on vacation.
Me either. Maybe like in the shallow end of the pool.
You know,
one of those inner tube things, maybe with a Donald Duck head on it.
Especially a vacation where there's someplace sunny. I mean, the only thing I think he'd like to do would be go caving.
He is like so pasty, man.
Where'd you go on your vacation, Jeremy?
Luray Cavern. It was great.
Hello. It was deep underground. It was cool. And it didn't affect my very fair skin.
No, we're not getting anywhere.
Hold on.
It's a lazy country, Jamaica.
You know, it might be a crapshoot, though, to try the pool bar to see what's happening. You know, if you hear, maybe you hear those steel drums in the background.
All right, and now it's busy. It's probably the one line going into the hotel that we're still on the other line.
Into the country.
There was a guy so pasty. He was so pasty, sitting in his inner tube in the middle of the pool, that he burned up like a little chip.
No, he checked out. Because we didn't have a bidet, man. It's a machine that washes your buttocks, man.
He's at the all-you-can-eat buffet. Eating his weight in food.
It's like a handful.
He might be out buying voodoo dolls of us right now. All right, now, one of them is named Don, and the other one is named Mike. And I hate them very, very much.
Please, whatever you do, don't let them through.
All right, we'll try one more time.
Huh.
Beauty.
Excellent, man.
Hello?
It seems like we got this. Hello?
Yes, hello. This is Don and Mike again, the chaps that are doing the radio show.
He's here. Pick up the line.
Okay, thank you.
Wonderful.
Oh, good.
Thank you.
Hello?
Yeah.
Jeremy.
Hello?
Jeremy.
Hi, Jeremy. It's us.
Hey.
We found you.
Hey, listen, Jeremy. It's me.
Very
I have a question for you.
Yes, sir.
How come yesterday when you were talking to Buzz about that commercial he was thinking about doing? When I walked by and I said, listen, let's talk about the pay-per-view tomorrow, how come you said yes? And I said, really? And you said, hey, I promise. How come you just lied to me? Because you knew you were going to Jamaica.
You know, when you walked by and you said that, I was thinking, you know, I just said that I would do that tomorrow. And then I thought, you know what, I'm going to be in Jamaica. I'll figure it out later.
Yeah, right. So.
But no, I didn't mean to lie to you. I was just like, you were walking fast and I was talking to Buzz and I was like, oh, yeah, whatever.
Whatever was that? That
whatever.
Through your, you sound like you got that Jamaica mindset, Jeremy.
Oh, yeah.
How's your
comfortable place.
Have you got a bad sunburn yet?
No, just got here.
Oh.
How come you just couldn't take the time just to say, listen, I won't be in tomorrow? I mean, you were around here the whole rest of the day, right?
Don is very hurt, Jeremy, that you lied to him.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean that.
Well, that's insulting.
Well, I didn't mean for you to be insulted.
Well, how would you feel? You lied right to my face.
I didn't. Well,
Yes, you did. I said, tomorrow? And you looked me right in and you said, yes. And then I said, really? Because you have a habit of not being around sometimes when we're supposed to have a meeting. And you said, really?
Just, put it in a hypothetical situation. Say you're the guy that, wants to have a really bad meeting. Say it's Tammy. You want to have a big meeting with Tammy. And Tammy says, tomorrow. I promise you tomorrow. Then you're going to have the meeting and you get to Tammy's door and there are these tiny little minuscule letters on the door that say, have gone to Jamaica.
No, it didn't say gone to Jamaica. I had to find that out on my own. It said out of town Thursday and Friday.
Ah, yeah, Jamaica, man.
Well, I am sorry. I didn't mean to insult you at all.
Well, I know you're just following the precedent set down by Commodore Stevens. But I'm tired of you guys lying to me and being so two-faced and everything.
It's frustrating.
And do something to make it up to you?
Yeah. How about have the meeting with me? Have the meeting with me. Hello?
I guess it was...
Pardon me?
Yeah, all of a sudden there was silence on the other end.
This is, again, the confrontation thing. You know, and how confrontational am I being? Please have the meeting with me that you've been supposed to have with me for like a month about this.
Well, we've talked on and off, but I was just waiting for all the right answers. But no, I didn't mean to blow you off in the hallway. I'm sorry, I did not mean to upset you.
How are we going to get the project done in time with you in Jamaica?
I got this all worked out.
You know something? You know what I think might be a real solution to this problem? I think you should come back from Jamaica right now.
That would make it okay with me, Mike.
Would you?
I wouldn't have lied to you.
The roles were reversed, would you?
No, here's the deal. No, because I wouldn't have lied to you. I would have just been man enough to say, listen, I'm not going to be around tomorrow.
Well, no, you are absolutely right. I didn't mean to lie to you, and I guess in retrospect...
Why is that? Why are you so afraid of just saying I'm going to be out of town? Why are you such a pussy?
I didn't take it as being a pussy. Why are you being so mean?
Because, man, you're over there sunning your buns and having your little drink with the umbrella in it. You know, and I'm here busting my ass thinking about this big project, and you want to go over and try to get a suntan. That's why.
Are you in one of those resorts that are gated, that has the gates around it?
All-inclusive?
Kinda. Yeah.
You know how you can make it right? Just go into town today in just your bathing suit.
All right, we'll try the Marriott burger.
A creep.
No,
okay.
Well,
just write that down. Just write that down.
He said he was sorry.
Okay, thanks, Jeremy.
I'm serious. Is there anything I can do to make it right?
Yep.
You're not serious. You're in Jamaica. You know you're looking for... You're not thinking about us. You're thinking about your next buffet.
When is the meeting going to happen when we can get some of the details worked out?
I will, if you would like, call you at 6 a.m. Monday morning.
Why would you do that? I would be sleeping at 6 a.m. Monday morning.
All right, whenever you wake up. I mean, first thing the second I get back, I'll give you a call if you'd like.
What time would that be?
When do I get back?
Yes.
Well, actually, I get back Sunday night.
Okay. What time Sunday night?
But plane lands at like 9 o'clock at night.
Mm-hmm. 9 o'clock.
Call you then.
Oh, just call me from the plane.
Honest to God, I'm not like holding out or doing anything underhanded. I was just okay.
You just didn't want to, you know, you were going to Jamaica and you didn't want to have a big.
You just wanted to lie to my face. That's okay.
I also,
that's all right. Just a big bold faced lie. Just I got here, you know, going down to your office with all my papers and everything. They were going to have the meeting. I see that, you know, in your little handwriting.
I was trying to keep it a secret that I'm in Jamaica because, you know, people might think less of me. I don't know.
All right. Well, it's a secret now.
You mean like the people that work around here that already know that you were off in London last weekend while the station is, you know, crumbling around here, and there's no decisive management in place. I guess you didn't want people to know you're taking another holiday.
All right.
I got you. No problem. Secret safe with me. I'll see you.
Oh, you little germ. I'll give that a round of applause.
You little germ.
We got him. We got him.
You little germ. You know, what would the problem have been just saying, hey, listen, I'm going to be out of town.
That's the whole style. You've aced it. It is the management style here at our radio station in Washington, D.C. That is how they do it. It is easier in their minds. It's not smarter, and it's not logical business practice, but it is easier in their minds to say, I could tell him I'm going to be in Jamaica, but no, that might not. And then while he's weighing it, suddenly it gets to that point in time where it's whatever. And then nothing happens, and you have been.
You know what I guess
to.
It is? I guess is that nobody else around here ever calls these guys on it because these guys are the boss, right?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So like normally, if the boss, you know, lies to you or something, you don't go back to the boss and say, "Hey,
exactly,
you know, you prick, why are you lying to me?" God, I hope he gets sun cancer. I really do.
You mean skin cancer?
Yeah, that's right, Mike. Skin cancer. You get it from the sun, right?
You do. Sun cancer.
Hope he gets a nice big melanoma. Is that one of those?
Yes.
One of those big shanker babies?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So anyway.
He won't be in the sun. You know he won't be in the sun. As a matter of fact, I understand when he's going out, he's in one of those carriages, one of those rickshaws that's draped in black crepe. You know, that's what he's got. Looks like
he probably wears like a bug keeper's hat, too, when he's there. You know, the guy that has the veil in front of it and everything?
Sure. Looks like an old-fashioned hearse that they pull him around in. Okay, I'd like to go to this store now. Let's get some T-shirts for my friends. And then they part the black crepe that's draped over the rickshaw, and he's hustled inside in his all-black beekeeper's his all-black beekeeper's outfit.
I would like 2 voodoo dolls, please.
Oh, yeah, man. What names do you want me to put on the doll?
All right, one is Don.
Yes.
And the other one is Mike, please. But don't touch me. Don't touch me.
Oh, I won't touch you, man. Here are your 2 Don and Mike dolls. Take it back into your hearse-like rickshaw and go back to the resort in your black beekeeper's hat.
Then go inside and shut all the blinds. Make the room ice cold.
I'd like some more food sent up. And please, tell the waiter when he comes to the door not to open it so wide so that hideous sun gets inside.
The island of Dr. Coleman. Not the island of Dr. Moreau.
Dr. Coleman cannot see the sun.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Meb.
What? Hello?
Yes, it's Don and Mike Show?
Yeah, hello.
Hi there.
Oh, hello.
Are you putting callers on the line at this point?
Mr. Clean, you're on the air.
Listen, I got a question. There's a buddy of mine in college who used the phrase to describe a certain type of woman, and I wanted to know if you guys ever heard it, if you ever used it.
All right, what is the phrase?
The phrase is a Zoom pig.
A Zoom pig.
I have never heard. I've never heard Zoom.
Never heard of it.
No.
Okay, here's what a Zoom pig is, according to my buddy. Let's say you're in the city driving in your car. You see about a block away a magnificent babe. You know.
Right. Okay.
Right. We know.
Well, sir. And she's got, like, teeth missing, and all of a sudden, you know, the bueno water boost.
Why is she a Zoom pig, then?
Because when you zoom in as if it's zooming in on a lens, what you thought was great turned out to be a Zoom pig. And you know,
no,
get out of the store and you go, oh, no.
Well, what fraternity did you go to? Llama Llama Retard? What is that?
Highly disappointing. I was very... Have you ever had, and I think most guys have had this experience, where you see an incredible head of hair, like straight, long, blonde hair.
Oh, then she turns around.
And sometimes it can even be a guy.
Yeah. And does it look like one of the Three Stooges? Like Larry's face or something?
Hello, Mom.
mouth.
On a lady's body. Hello, Donna Mike. Is that our original guy?
Didn't sound like him.
Hello, Donaldo E. Miguel.
Hi, I'm Jeremy Coleman calling back from Jamaica. I am so sorry. You have ruined my two-day getaway, my holiday.
You're on the air. Hello.
Yeah, I think what that guy was trying to call about was strobe light honeys.
All right, same thing, sir. It's just equally stupid.
I'm still working on Wobbly Pop.
Oh, that was from yesterday's show, Mike.
Yeah, I enjoy a good wobbly, or maybe even 2 days ago. I like a good Wobbly Pop.
Hello, Donna Mike Show. Hello.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
Yeah, how could you let Jeremy get away with that?
And exactly what am I supposed to do? I called him out on it. I called him a liar.
Here you are in Washington. You could have gone ahead and said, Jeremy, you like your office? Guess what we're going to do to that office when you get back?
You have to understand. You have to understand something.
Come on, listen. We have to work in a corporate structure.
Do you understand that this is our immediate supervisor and that there are standards that have to be observed?
I understand there's standards, but look at the weasel number of this guy.
Hey, listen, I agree. What do you want me to do, man?
I'm really disappointed because...
Who are you disappointed in?
Hey, Baxter Heck.
Okay, Mr. Armchair Troublemaker.
I know.
So easy.
Listen, I just want to say something to you.
Make this guy's 3 days miserable.
Whatever you do for a living, you would never have the balls to tell your boss anything.
I've got my own business.
Telemarketing. I'm so tired of guys that try to sell magazine subscriptions.
Never pull a weasel.
Say they're in telemarketing.
Well, you would never tell. All right, so it's not your boss. You would never tell your best customer anything if they screwed you over. You would never do that. You wouldn't. It's the same thing.
I would never pull a weasel move like
that. And hold on.
But I work with.
Well, okay, now what you're saying is you wouldn't do what Jeremy did, but what I'm saying is if a guy like Jeremy, if your boss did that to you, you wouldn't have the balls to confront him, much less do it in a forum in front of 4 million people.
You know how we have already ruined his weekend?
No, you
haven't. It's been totally disruptive.
You were too diplomatic the way you handled the whole thing.
I'm not going to take a critique from a guy who doesn't have the balls to say anything to his own boss.
I am the boss.
You are, but you weren't always the boss, were you?
Yes.
Oh, so from 16 on, when you were 16 years old, Mr. Armchair Troublemaker. 21. From 21 on, you've been here. What, do you deliver pizzas?
Not quite.
All right, well, what do you do?
Well, don't bust my chops. I mean, you're...
No. You called to bust my chops.
We have every right to bust your chops because you're busting our chops.
I just can't... You have let people...
Now, listen, I'm sorry, but the spotlight was turned on you.
Now, listen.
The question was asked of you. What do you do?
I'm an international export.
You're an... So, what are you, some sort of Boz? You're an international export? You mean you're an international exporter?
Yes, that's correct.
What do you export?
Yeah, it's tough, isn't it, now, when the spotlight's turned on you?
Well, come on, listen.
Listen, I'm not looking for a fight. I'm just not going to take any crap from some guy who wouldn't have the balls to do half of what I did.
Hear that phone ringing? That's one of your clients that just recognized your voice.
That's a fax machine.
That's why he's sending you a fax, because he recognized your voice and knows you're an international exporter.
Maybe I just can't believe that you let him get away.
Is it getting warmer? Is it getting warmer now in your little international export business?
No.
Yeah.
It's just that I think you guys actually sit down and reflect on this over the weekend.
Oh, kiss my ass. Reflect on that, you Pier 1 wannabe. Piece of garbage. F you. Go sell some wicker baskets, you piece of crap. God damn it. Hello? I mean, really.
Thought we had a good time with Jeremy. And he just peed all over our fun.
There's nothing... I'm a guy. There's nothing I would hate worse than another guy calling me up and just saying man to man, you lied to me.
Right.
You're a big pussy.
Remember what happened when Mama, in Throw Mama from the Train, said that to Owen? You lied to me. Remember? And then Owen turns to Billy Crystal and looks at him and says, you lied to me, and hits him right in the head with a frying pan.
Yeah. Clonk. Hello, Donna Mike.
Hi, Don. Hi, Mike.
Hi there.
Hey, Don, the solution is you're definitely the man to tell him, but you should just fly down and have the meeting with him at the company's expense. He's the one who raised...
Everybody that's listening to this show is living in some kind of a fantasy sitcom world. Okay, first off, I have responsibilities. I got to come to work every day. Tomorrow, as a matter of fact, I got to go to a funeral. I got a thing to do at my kid's school on Saturday. I got an appointment on Sunday. Point number one. Point number two, think about that. Let's say I just do drop everything on the company's dime.
Right.
How would I do that? How would I do that? How do I go get
money? Wouldn't
you
have to surprise Jeremy Goldman in his hotel room?
No, but the issue is not the meeting. The issue is that Dom was lied to. The issue is not the meeting. The meeting is important, albeit it's important.
Can I give you my boss's phone number?
No. If you've got anything to say to your boss, say it to him yourself.
No, I think he'd be a much better person to do it for me.
You know something?
He did such a good job with Jeremy.
I think you ought to go into the import-export business.
Listen, I wish there was such a thing as do this on the company's money.
Yeah.
But there's not such a thing.
Well, maybe you could call him every 5 minutes.
That would make for a great show, wouldn't it?
In the middle of the night.
All right, I'll do that. I'll stay up all night tonight. Just call him every 5 minutes.
Are you? Do you like the show?
I love you guys.
Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied with the show?
Totally, 100%.
Then stop it! Please.
Yes, sir.
All right, goodbye.
You know what you should do? Now, what it is, and I'll tell you exactly what it is. A lot of people, we say it all the time, when we get into, like, arguments with people and you hear people do, you know, live vicariously through this show because they love to hear the confrontation. And sometimes they want, really, what they would love is like, someone to pull out a gun and pump a few bullets because living vicariously, that's the ultimate satisfaction because that's what they'd love to do with a coworker.
Trust me, I'd love to shoot Jeremy Coleman. If I lived in a world where I didn't have to worry about anything.
Right, there was no payoff. You didn't have to do a payback.
I'd love to shoot him Goodfellas style.
Mm-hmm.
That thing where the first one goes through his head,
right.
You see all the blood, and then when he's on the ground, you pop him 9 or 10 more times.
Pam, 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 pam.
But I can't do that.
No, it's we have laws in this country.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, man, how's it going?
Hey, my friend.
Hey, just got back from the islands listening to that exporter.
Yes.
And fixing dinner, and I'm putting some jerk seasoning on my meat right now. But hey, I saw something a little bit outside of Ocho Rios that y'all would like.
What are you talking about?
It's called
jerk seasoning. Is your jerk seasoning, does that come in a squeeze tube or is that sprinkle on seasoning?
Well, it's the powdered form.
Powdered form.
Oh, powdered form.
See a doctor.
Okay. Well, hey,
hello, Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, can I talk to Don and Mike?
Hi, you are on the air.
I'm on the air?
Right, listen, I'm sorry. Everybody seems to be trying my patience today.
Well, maybe it's that way. It's Thursday. It's Thinking Thursday.
Hello, it's Don and Mike Show.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Buddy.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Yes, Buddy.
Hey, why don't you guys call and leave some messages for Jeremy like you did in Japan years ago when you first came to the station?
All right, what kind of messages would you like us to leave?
You know, like the station's burning down and he needs to call right away.
You're such an idiot.
You know, we've already made contact with Jeremy. Don't you think he would see right through that? Yes, he would.
Yeah, come on now, please.
Come on now.
Please, don't insult me like that. Come on.
All right, I love you guys. Take care.
Well, I hate you. Hey, goodbye. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hello, Don and Mike.
I should point out again, probably another guy that had a difficult day at work.
Yeah.
It was. Listen, why don't you, how about running a pontoon boat, going down on a cruise ship, and then breaking into Jeremy's hotel room and strangling him while he sleeps. I had a real tough day at work, and I love your show.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Now, as you know, the San Diego Zoo is one of the finest zoos in the world, and we've had this young lady on the show very often the past, I guess, 7 or 8 years she's been appearing with us.
9 years.
Hmm?
About 9 years.
Right, yeah. Several plus several would be about 9.
You said 7 or 8.
No, I didn't say 7 or 8. I said several.
Then you said 7 or 8, and I said 9.
Yes. 9, good, thank you.
Some of the animals you had as babies are now 10 years old.
That would be about right.
Remember the animals that did something funny on your tie?
Yes.
Those little lions, the little baby lions, were 1 year old.
That's right.
They are now treacherous and ferocious 10-year-old animals.
Okay. Anyway, Joan Embry is here tonight.
And she's now 32.
That's right. Joan is an animal handler and a trainer. And you really think you're fooling everybody, don't you?
No.
And she also...
I'm just here to do my best to help you.
I know that. And she does her 3 horse shows a day. Did you know that? At the animal park.
Boy.
What?
What an exciting idea.
Would you like an army cot or something? Maybe just kind of catch up on a little, little nappy poo? Just might snap you right out of it. Okay.
I love Joan. I'm the only one who went down to see Joan. Doc has never seen her. You've never seen her. I went to the Wild Animal Farm.
It's all right. It's all right.
But you're upsetting me.
No, I don't want to upset you.
I went down, Joan, and I
know you did. That's all right. Fine.
Don't say... No.
What?
I know her. I went down there.
Oh, I know you did. I know you went down there. And
I held a baby gorilla.
I couldn't go with you that week. You held a baby gorilla. Good. All right. And let's get her out here quickly. Would you welcome Joan Embry?
The Don and Mike Show.
Hold it, fellas. And don't move. Let's get real, real going, Miss Chase.
Bow to their capricious whims, Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Well, we are ready to try it.
Is this the new theme for the new feature?
Yes, that's right. The Don and Mike Orchestra in the background. It's our cell phone name game.
Yay!
Now, not really sure how this is going to work.
Oh, see, I thought you were, because I had no idea how it was going to work.
No, here's what we're going to do. We're going to get people calling the show right now at 1-800-636-1067. These people are going to have portable flip phones.
Right.
These people are going to call us from inside shopping malls.
Yes.
We will pay you $10 for every store you can go into and get away with asking for a name like, excuse me, I'm looking for Pat McGroin.
Okay.
Excuse me, I'm looking for Holden McGroin.
All right.
Excuse me, I'm looking for Mike Hunt.
Mm-hmm. All right.
I got a whole list of them here somewhere.
And $10 per store.
Per store. Like, you'll start, you can say, hey, Donna Mike, I'm going into the Gap now.
Right.
See, the reason... I can't talk with this music on. The reason for trying this... I was in a store recently, a couple of weeks ago... And a guy came in, a personal shopper came in, something like a Kathy Lee Gifford has, and he came into the store with a flip phone, and he said, excuse me, I am looking for Kathy Lee Gifford. Is she in the store? I'm her personal shopper, and I was down, and I lost her. Is she in the store? Could you make an announcement for me?
Right.
So they got on the store, and they said, Kathy Lee Gifford, Kathy Lee Gifford.
Okay.
So what you'll have to do is, now keeping in mind that you've got whoever it is on the other end of the phone that needs to talk to...
So the personal shopper was in there with the person on the phone.
Right. No. The personal shopper was looking for the person because they had split up.
Aha.
And the personal shopper had a phone call for Kathy Lee or whoever it was.
All right.
I mean, I don't care how you do it, folks, when you get to the mall.
Now, do they have to go into the big stores so that they can page?
Yeah, that would work best.
And you only get the money if we hear the page, right?
Yeah. Okay. That would be perfect.
Oh, well, that's what I'm thinking. Go into the big store and you get the money if we hear the page.
If they page the name Holden McGroin.
That's right.
And you say you got a phone call for Holden McGroin. And you know, as a matter of fact, being as most stores that have the intercoms are only located on the corners of the mall.
Yeah, the big stores.
I tell you what, we'll just do it. If you get them to do it, we'll give you $100.
Get them to do it once, and if we hear the page,
so you don't have to go from store to store.
And that's where having the little flip phone works.
And this would work even not in the shopping mall. Go to Walmart,
Kmart.
Yeah, something like that. We used to do this thing where we would have the people that work inside the stores actually make announcements about our program.
Go to the airport.
If you're flying the airport.
That's where I heard Major Woody.
And that'll be another one we use. Now we're going to compile our list of names during the commercial break here.
Good.
And we'll give you a name when you call us.
That's right, the designated name of the day.
You get that name paged in a store, in a shopping mall, in an airport. We'll give you $100, and I'll also give you some of this X-Files stuff.
I like it.
So that's how we do it. And that's why the orchestra's playing their brains out. The thing that I think is going to make this so good is not even necessarily hearing the page, but getting the sound of the people on the telephone going to the desk asking for someone to be paged. Now,
but as far as getting the sound of the page, really, if you can find where the speakers are, position yourself under the speakers and hold that phone up so we can hear it.
We hear it, you'll get $100.
Yeah.
Phil McCrevis, Pat McGroin.
Boy, Pat McGroin's awfully strong.
You want to start with Pat McGroin?
Yeah, because Pat McGroin, you can hear clearly, too. And there's no way around. It's been my experience, you know, they sometimes switch it to Michael. But let's see what happens.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello, Don and Mike Show. Who is this?
Hey, this is Eric.
Hi, Eric. Now, without giving the name of the shopping center you're at a major shopping center?
Yep.
Well, what state you calling from?
Virginia.
State of Virginia.
Yep.
What store is it that you're going to be going to?
The Gap.
It's got to be a bigger store than the Gap.
How about the Bombay store?
Bombay's?
No. You're not related to Tom Gavin, are you?
Nope.
Listen, hold on a second.
Hold on. See, let me get another call here. Hello.
Now. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hi, how you doing today?
Great. Who's this, please?
There we go.
Chet Cockrell.
Chet.
Yes.
Chet. Where are you from, Chet?
I'm from Centerville, Virginia.
And what store are you going to try this game in?
CVS.
CVS. Now, that would work a drugstore. You know they got a paging system in a drugstore.
That's right.
Because they page you to tell you your prescription is ready.
Ah, you're right. Okay, good.
That makes sense.
All right, the name we'd like is Pat McGroin.
Okay.
So now what we'd like to hear is you walk into the store, walk up to the pharmacy counter, tell the guy that there's someone in the store you'd like paged. You have a call for him.
So you need to have somebody paged.
Okay, I'm walking to the store right now.
Okay.
Good luck.
CVS it's not a grocery store, it's a drugstore.
Drugstore.
Right.
It's a discount drugstore.
And that's why the pharmacist has such a power trip, because the pharmacist gets, you know, I've got a theory on that. I've said that many times. The pharmacists are on a superpower trip because, look at me, I'm up so high.
That's right.
And what a job it is. You count out pills. Come on, sure. Forrest Gump could do that.
How you doing, sir? I'm looking for my dad. His name is Pat McGroin. Can you page him for me?
Doing an awful job.
Pat McGroin. Pat McGroin. Can you page him for me?
Oh, my God. We have a winner.
He did it. Wow, that was easy.
You did it.
That was easy.
And he said it like three times, too.
All right.
Well, listen, my friend, Chet, you won $100.
Fantastic.
All right, let me give you this X-Files stuff. X-Files merchandise included in X-Files membership kit, paperback copy of the book Ground Zero from HarperCollins, a video from Fox Home Video not available in stores, and 4 X-Files phone cards from Frontier. Watch the all-new X-Files Grotesque episode Friday at 9 on your local Fox station.
Great.
That's how you do it.
Go on.
Wow, that was just too easy.
That's too easy. Now, that's one where he walks up to the counter. You can also do this if you happen to be in an airport where you walk up to that paging phone and you let us listen in.
Sure.
And then you race over to where the speaker is.
That's where we've had some of our favorite gags.
Absolutely. Don, Mike?
Yes.
Can I try this again at the Weiss Market?
All right, I tell you what, but no money this time.
Okay.
Just do it for snicks. All right, this time, I'll give you a real challenge. Try Michael Hunt.
Michael Hunt?
But call him Mike when you get up there.
Mike Hunt. Okay.
That's his name.
All right, I'm heading out here now. Hey, what happens if I get disconnected?
Well, then you're disconnected and we'll never see you again and you'll never get your money.
Oh, that's terrible.
Just call back for your dough.
Okay.
And where are you going to now?
I'm going to Weiss Market.
What's that, a grocery store?
It's a grocery store.
Yeah, and you know what? That's another excellent suggestion, because they do page people in grocery stores.
Absolutely.
You know, now that we're doing this, I see all the possibilities. It doesn't have to be a shopping mall.
No, it can be anywhere.
Okay.
Anywhere they page people.
And what is it? Michael what?
Hunt.
Mike Hunt.
Right.
All right.
All right. Very good.
I'm entering the mall right now.
I got that prickly feeling. It's got to be good.
Okay.
All right.
Front counter. There's the deli, produce, dairy.
You know, maybe that first guy we had on hold could find a store that has a paging system.
Here we go.
He was by the Gap. Here we go.
I'm looking forward to our first turnaround, too.
Ma'am, do you guys have a paging system here? Do you have a paging system here? You don't have a paging system here.
Oh.
Do you have a pharmacy? Do you have a pharmacy? You don't have anything over I can go over the mic with to page somebody?
He's helping to please.
Yes, he is.
Weiss Market doesn't have one.
You still get the money.
Great.
Hold on, my friend. All right, now who's that? We only got two guys for this? Is it still the same first guy? Hello?
Hello?
Who's this?
Hi, Eric.
Hi, Eric. Hey. Eric, you figure out, are there any stores there that might have a paging system?
No one that's big enough.
Okay.
Okay, Doug.
You can hang up now.
All right, bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
I think it was a little too challenging an effort for him.
Let me take another call. Hi, Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, this is John.
Hi, John. Where are you calling from?
Sioux City.
Sioux City, fantastic. What store are you going to try?
Shopko.
Shopko. All right, this I tell you what. Phil McCrevis.
Phil McCrevis.
All right.
Phil McCrevis, that's your name. We'll use the Michael Hunt as the second one.
Okay.
If we give them a chance to maybe double their prize.
Absolutely.
Do it right now?
Okay. Yeah, right now. Let us just hear the whole conversation.
Okay, hold on just a second. I'll see
you. Going to Shopko. That's like the Midwest Walmart, right?
Yep, that's right.
Gotcha.
Yep, hold on.
He's put his hand over the receiver. His answer?
Yeah, he did. But he's asking. He said Mike Crevis.
They're paging him right now.
Ask her to do it. I didn't ask her to do it one more time and see if you can hold the phone right up by the speaker.
Yeah, and don't cover it up when you're asking. We want to hear what you're doing.
Well, he's going to put us on the phone.
She did page him.
It's Phil McCrevis.
Oh, you wanted Phil.
Yeah, see, Mike McCrevis makes no... Do you get it? Phil McCrevis?
I think...
Hello?
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Don and Mike Show. Who's this?
Rod.
Hi, Rod. Where are you from?
From Baltimore.
Rod?
Hey, I'm not at a store, but I got a good name you can try.
You know, I think we're going to stick with the names we have.
Yeah, we got a lot of names.
All right.
Okay.
Hi.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
See you later.
Bye-bye, man.
How about Haywood?
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 Haywood what? He's gone.
That's it. Just
boo.
Haywood. Hi, Don and Mike Show.
Well. Yeah, is he taking just regular calls now?
No, are you listening to the show?
Yes.
You hear what we're trying to do?
No, I just got in.
Well, now, wait a minute. Make up your mind.
I'm going to give you a call.
You what?
I want to know if you're going to come to any station in Pittsburgh.
Are you by a shopping mall right now where you could be paged, possibly?
No, I'm not.
No, you're not. Okay. Well, I have to leave this line open for someone who will be Phil McCrevis.
All right.
Okay.
See you.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
And then later on, is this the same
Hello?
Guy?
Hello?
It's the guy in Sioux City again.
Yeah. My battery's going dead, Don.
What?
My battery's going dead.
Okay. Now.
Now, you wanted Phil. You didn't want Mike, right?
Hold on. Do you understand why Phil McCrevis is funny?
Yeah, I got it. I understand.
And Mike McCrevis is not funny.
Yes, I understand. I didn't.
Unless you wanted to do a broadcast from your butt.
You wanted his brother Phil, right?
Try it again. Try Phil McCrevis. And let us hear the whole conversation.
Yeah,
please.
Hold that. Make sure we can hear you asking, okay?
Well, I'm at the counter right now.
All right.
He's on the phone here at the counter.
All right, go ahead.
All right.
Go ahead.
You paid Phil McCrevis for me.
Did you hurry? My battery's going dead here. I'm sorry. Don?
Yeah.
Don?
Yes.
Okay, I'm just trying to make sure my battery is
dead. Yes, just don't worry about us. Worry about the person in the store.
Oh, man.
So close.
I'm going to start calling this game Honk for Cell Phone.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
I just want to give you Haywood's last name.
Don't forget,
Jeff
though.
Jeff Lomey.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah, that's an old one. Thank you, my friend. Thank you. The first guy did it right.
Yeah, the first guy aced it.
The very first guy.
This is not complex. I don't think this has the complexity of Honk for Cash.
Well, Honk for Cash is a simple game, really.
Okay, that scares me, though.
Hello.
Hello.
Don and Mike Show. Who's this?
This is Tim Mayer.
Tim, where are you from?
From Burtonsville.
Tim, what store are you going to be going into?
Right here, right outside CVS.
Okay, Phil McCrevis. That's your name.
Phil McCrevis. Okay.
All right, that's the name you're looking for.
Okay, hold on.
Good luck to you.
Phil McCrevis.
It's gonna take a little time, but that first guy aced it. And at some point when we play the game again,
I was out in the parking lot, so I'm coming in.
I want a Major Woody page.
Oh, you got it.
All right.
You got it. You want Major Woody and I want Michael Hunt. Hello?
You can tell he's in the store now.
Excuse me. Is there a place where I can get someone paged overhead?
You know, Dick Cheese would be good, too.
Yeah,
though.
I need
Cheese.
To find someone in the store.
Go to the information desk.
Go to the information desk.
No, they're in CVS here.
CVS?
Yeah, do you have a paging system?
I don't like the manager over there.
This is great. Now, this is just voyeurism.
I like the process.
Excuse me.
Right, here we go.
Sir? Excuse me, I'm sorry. I'm trying to find someone in the CVS here. Are you able to page them? Pardon me? Could you?
What's the name?
Phil McCrevis.
Okay, he's gonna do it.
Phil McCrevis to the parking lot side of CVS. Phil McCrevis.
Yeah.
beautiful.
Oh, that's great.
You won $100.
All right.
And I'll give you all the same. Give you all the same X-Files stuff also.
Excellent.
From our friends at Fox Broadcasting. Thank you for listening.
Okay.
Hold on a second.
Oh, good job.
Now the question is, do we stop here now that it's worked, or do we try that one more?
That could be disastrous.
Yeah.
I think we have to. That's why should we break with tradition?
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, I finally got through.
Yes, who's this, please?
This is Dana calling from Portland, Maine.
Hi, Dana, what story are you going to go into?
Well, actually, I'm working, but I just had to call you guys. I have a new name.
No names. Everybody can call with a name.
Hi, Don and Mike Show.
Don.
Yes.
Hey, how's it going, man?
Fine. Who's this?
Hey, this is Dan from Alexandria.
Dan, are you by a store?
No, I'm not. Actually, I have a name for you.
Yeah, of course you do.
Right. That's the end of it for today. Should have stopped.
Yep.
Should have listened to you, Buzz. When I said, do we take another one, Buzz went, no.
Oh, yeah.
We will hone and refine this game, and we will try it again very shortly.
Phil McCrevice.
He said it twice.
Perfect.
Looking for Phil McCrevice. Shopko paging Phil McCrevice.
That was quality.
Good.
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Fresh corn on the cob is irresistible, especially at Safeway's low prices. This week we got Washington-grown Canada number one corn on the cob, valued priced at three cops for 88 cents. Do it right. Sorry about this, I didn't know it was... And goddamn Whitey produced... And commercials never come out the right way. Okay. Safeway's got everything. It's 88 cents for the corn and everything you need for a super summer barbecue. Charcoal, starter, napkins, and paper plates at Brockett Safeway.
The Don and Mike Show. National Treasures. Don and Mike.
Joining us now is the guy who's written this brand new book, Elvis, Unknown Stories Behind the Legend. Here's this guy, Jim Curtin. Hello, Jim.
How are you?
Hey, my friend.
Fascinating stories in that book, Jim.
Thank you very much.
We love the book. Thank you for being on the show. If you don't mind, let me just ask you about some stuff that we've noticed in here. Maybe you could paraphrase some of your best stuff in this book.
Okay.
Let me see. We've already talked.
I have some stories already picked.
Well, why don't you let me pick them? How about we talk about, we already talked about Elvis's nude statues.
Yeah, we already painted them cobalt blue.
Talked about Elvis's ass blisters.
Mm-hmm.
What about, here's one you're famous for. He got a lot of publicity. Elvis's stinky feet.
Yeah, his foot odor, that was something we, you know, all the years we've been talking about Elvis on this show, we never knew about the foot odor. How did that story come your way?
Well, back in the 1950s, before Elvis Presley became the king of rock and roll, he used to go on tour with Scotty Moore and Bill Black, and while they were touring the country, you know, all of them were basically poor. They didn't even have any money to barely eat, not long, you know, get their socks washed. Well, Elvis used to, you know, wear the socks for weeks at a time. And what he would do is he would build up all the socks and put them in a suitcase. And after about maybe 2, 3, 4 weeks of touring, Elvis would take him back home and give the suitcase to his mom. And the stench was so powerful that Gladys had to wear like a kerchief around her nose. After this happened a few times, Gladys got upset and threw the suitcase in the trash.
Because the suitcase was just reeking?
Yeah, she couldn't tolerate the odor anymore.
All right, let me ask you about another one in your book here. How about Elvis Buys Love in 1966? Where he's got his brother-in-law, his stepbrother up there in his room. One time in 1966, Elvis was in extremely good mood while hosting a party at Graceland.
Okay, stepbrother.
He had his entourage and friends bring girlfriends to the party, and those girls were instructed to bring their girlfriends.
Yeah, I can't recall the story right now. I can't recall that story right now.
Oh. Do you write the book?
That's why I'm sorry, what? Well, there was another party I could tell you about.
Is there some committee there that's coaching you on this, or
well,
what's going on? We heard you. Get the stepbrother story for me.
No, let me tell you what's going on. See, I'm going through 3,000 stories, and I'm making 5 volumes.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, all right.
And I haven't seen that book for over a year.
Is there anything that's super good that you haven't written yet?
Oh, sure. Yeah, there's a lot of things.
Can you give us a tidbit? Can you give us a little sneak preview?
I'd rather not. You know, like Elvis always said, you know, that I don't want to tell you too much. You have to come and see the show. Well, I feel the same way about my book.
Oh, listen, Jim, I'm positive. We'll sell some books for you today on the show.
But I can tell you a couple of stories that I have, you know, recalled in my memory bank.
Okay.
There's a story about Elvis on the set of Fun in Acapulco. During that trapeze segment. It was the very last piece that was being filmed that day, and that was to complete the film. Well, Elvis was wearing leotards. He told his bodyguards to take his wardrobe home. This is the last day of shooting.
Right.
So after he shot the trapeze segment, he went back to his dressing room, and the phone rang. And here it was Hal Wallace. He says, listen, we need some photographs taken of you for publicity purposes. You got to come back in. All of a sudden, Elvis panics, and he calls one of his bodyguards. He says, listen, you got to bring my clothes back, TCB. That means lightning fast.
TCB.
Right. So what he did is he jumped into Elvis's car. He flew back home to go get Elvis's wardrobe, and in the process of it, he ran over and killed a gardener who was taking care of the famous people's homes.
Wow. Now that's one we had not heard before.
And
Jim,
Elvis was devastated over it, and it took him years to get over it. He always felt the blame because of that situation.
Because the guy that was going to get his clothes ran over the gardener.
Yeah, he was right, exactly. Mm-hmm. He was sued for $300,000.
Oh my God. Wow.
You never heard about this. Hey, listen, off the top of your head, let me ask you, I've got a whole bunch here that maybe you can pick one that you can remember something about, okay?
I have about three dozen picked here myself.
Okay, well, let's see if we match up on any of these.
All right.
We are we're fascinated with a story about Hamburger James. You got anything about him?
Hamburger James?
Yeah, James Caldwell? Or that's not his name, is it?
What's Caldwell. Well, he's the guy that stole the TCB ring, one of Elvis's rings.
Oh, he stole one of his rings.
Yes.
We heard the story about him going to the airport and stealing money from the kid.
And Elvis picked up a coffee table and was going to bash him in the head with it, but then he thought different and he just started crying.
Well, he found out, that he stole the ring, and he went to the airport to go after him. He stopped the plane. Elvis stopped the plane, and he got a hold of him, and he got his ring back.
Wow. All right, what about Scatter the Monkey? We've heard lots about...
Scatter the Monkey was unbelievable. This monkey was not only an alcoholic, but he was a womanizer. He, you know, at all the parties, he used to go around lifting up all the skirts.
Oh.
And the guests used to have all their glasses, you know, around the tables and everything, and Scatter would go around drinking all the leftover alcohol that was in the glasses, and by the end of the evening, he was cockeyed drunk.
Mm.
So he also used to walk around with a big giant cigar and a little jacket on, like Colonel Parker. And Elvis used to roar with laughter because of this mimic. He could not believe that Scatter was, you know, mimicking Colonel Parker. You know, it was just unbelievable.
What is your connection to Elvis, and how do you have all these? How have you gone about getting these stories? I mean, were you close to anybody that's part of the Memphis Mafia?
I was close to Elvis. I was very fortunate, close to Elvis. I was close to Uncle Fester, Ed Parker.
Uncle Fester?
Yeah, Uncle Fester.
Oh, I thought you meant Adam
Fester
family.
Presley.
And how long were you
in? Just recently passed away, by the way.
Were you in the entourage?
Not in the entourage, but I knew everybody in the entourage.
Okay.
I used to, you know, go down there just like a fan in back in the 1960s, just like everybody else, trying to get a glimpse of Elvis. And I used to hang out at the gates and get to talk to all the uncles and the aunts and the neighbors and the friends and everything. And every time I heard a story, I was, you know, one of the biggest Elvis Presley fans around. What I would do is I would jot it down, stick it in my wallet, and just, you know, keep it. And before you know it, after 22, 23 years, I had a whole trunk of stories, facts, and information on Elvis.
Well,
so we decided to finally break it up and make a series.
The name of Jim's book is Elvis, Unknown Stories Behind the Legend. And there's all kinds of great stuff. Let me just give you one thing here. We've all heard about Elvis shooting at the TV.
Right.
We've heard about that it was supposedly Robert Goulet.
Mm-hmm.
But you have an exchange in here that cracks me up. Do you want to research that one? Do you have that one nearby? About the hemorrhoid commercial?
The hemorrhoid commercial.
Listen, one day in 1974,
mm-hmm.
Elvis was at home.
Yeah, Elvis was at home, you know, and Elvis had a real touchy stomach. Any little thing annoyed Elvis. You know, he was just funny that way. He was very, fussy.
Right.
He couldn't handle any type of disgusting things. And one day he was eating, watching TV, and there was a hemorrhoid commercial. And he was so aggravated over it, you know, that, you know, he's eating over here, and they're over there pushing hemorrhoids, you know, on TV. So he got his gun out and he shot it.
How about
shot the TV?
Listen to the detail that Jim has here. Okay, what Jim just said, he didn't like the hemorrhoid commercial. The advertisers had an actor talking about pain, itching, and swelling. Elvis could not continue eating. He threw his cheeseburger and the glass of milk at the TV and yelled, "Rub that on your ass, you son of a bitch." He picked up one of his guns and shot a bullet right through the TV.
Oh, right.
I'm trying to keep it clean, you know. I don't want to use any profanity because I do represent Elvis. I can't, you know. But you're right.
What do you mean you represent Elvis?
It really was.
What do you mean by that you represent Elvis?
Well, I mean, he's gone. He can't speak for himself now.
Right.
And, you know, as much as I loved Elvis, you know, I still, you know, in a way have to represent his voice now. And in doing so, I'm going to tell it like it is, and I'm going to tell the truth about everything. And I'm also going to uphold Elvis's image as much as possible.
Well,
if you notice, there's no drug stories in my book.
Well, yeah, Charlie, it's interesting because, I mean, there's so many
stories.
Hold on,
here's our producer running in.
There's a phone call you should take on hold there.
On hold?
Remember I told you someone I called earlier in the day?
I had no idea. What are you talking about?
She called back.
Okay. All right, hold on a second.
All right.
Oh, really? Hold on a second.
Okay.
A big thrill for us now. Now I remember. Thank you, Charlie. Joining us for the first time ever, Christopher, Christina, damn it. Christina Crawford.
Hey, Christina Crawford, thanks for coming on the show.
My brother's name is Christopher, so I have been called, not Christopher, but Chris, certainly.
Christina.
Oh, Christina, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I'm just very excited to have you on the telephone, Christina.
Thank you. This is, you know, I run a farm and a country inn in North Idaho, and I just came in from working outside to collect my messages. And there you are, and here we are together.
Yay. Here she is.
I don't ask much from you,
girl. Oh, yeah.
Why can't you give me the respect that I'm entitled to?
And then here you are.
Yes, and here I am.
Oh, why can't you treat me?
I thought this was about Elvis Presley.
Oh, it is. I'm just playing you, though.
On the street.
We just want, it's our favorite Mommy Dearest thing.
I am not one of your fans.
All right, we applaud the movie. Anywhere near close to reality, that little scene there?
No.
Okay.
It isn't. And but Diana Scarwood, I thought, did a very good job. And the 20th anniversary edition of Mommy Dearest is out. It is available only on the internet. It's on Amazon.com, and there's a Mommy Dearest website, so check it out.
Beautiful. We will listen, Christina. So glad you called us. Can you tell us about your relationship with Elvis?
Well, I was very fortunate to do one film with Elvis, and it was right immediately after he returned from the Army, and he was doing this film at 20th Century Fox Studios. I had been called by Fox to do a screen test. I was 21 years old, and I was thrilled. I was a young actress. I was working in New York. I had done a lot of theater, and I had done one film, and that was the extent of my career in the previous two or three years. So I was sent to Los Angeles. I was living in New York. I was sent to Los Angeles. I did a screen test. I had no idea for what picture or whatever. They gave me a contract. In those days, they still had the contract system. And needless to say, I was thrilled with just the contract with 20th Century Fox. It was a huge step for me in my career. And then they told me that they wanted me to do this film with Elvis Presley. Well, I just about fainted, as you can well imagine.
Sure.
And of course, all my friends thought that I had ascended to heaven. Anyway, I worked on the film from November of 1960 to early 1961, which meant that the holidays happened during the time that we were shooting the picture. And Elvis had a rented house in Bel Air, and he had a lot of his buddies from the Army with him, and he gave these wonderful parties. They were small parties. They were not lavish, and they were very casual, and they were basically just for us kids that were all on the picture. I mean, we were kind of all kids together.
Hey, Christina, what about when Elvis called you a bitch and threw a drink in your face?
Well, that was accidental, actually. There was a misunderstanding, and I don't think it was intended for me, actually, but that's what happened. And
he really did do that, though? He really did call you a bitch, and he threw a
Well, I don't
drink.
Remember that he called me a bitch. Elvis was a very, very religious person, as anybody who knew him knows. And basically, his great mentor and idol was Mahalia Jackson. He sang gospel beautifully, and this was...
Never thought I'd be bored by Christina Crawford. Yeah. Jesus Christ, I am.
That sometimes happen.
No wonder Ron yelled.
I beg your pardon?
No, excuse me.
What?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hold on a second, Christina. Hold on.
Buzz, I forgot your microphone is the only microphone that was not keyed.
Thought I was safe.
She couldn't hear you. Hey, Jim?
Yes.
Jim, listen, we still have Christina Crawford on the other line.
Yes, I met her mother back in 1968 at John Wanamaker's in Philadelphia.
Now, what Jim writes in the book is that Elvis did call her an unflattering name. He grabbed her by the hair, pulled her across the coffee table, and threw her out of the house. And then later, to make it okay, Elvis set up a couple of cases of Coca-Cola. Right?
Well, we got to find this out.
That's about right.
You standing by that story, Jim?
I stand behind it.
Okay.
To at least a 90% degree.
All right, hold on a minute. Hey, Christina, I apologize for that. Christina?
Hello?
Christina?
Oh, dear.
All right, well.
She's gone.
Nice going, Buzz.
I'm sorry.
I'm kidding you, Buzz. I am absolutely.
Hey, no great loss.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. What a bore she was. Jim, listen, sorry I broke into your valuable interview time.
Yeah, we were getting some interesting details about the King of Rock and Roll.
So, Jim, what do you know about that?
Well, I got a great story for you if you want to hear it.
Sure.
Around 1975, when Elvis was dating Linda Thompson, Linda Thompson was starting to become very irritable about the bodyguards always being around. Elvis could never go anywhere without the bodyguards. So one day she convinced Elvis, listen, Elvis, it's all in your mind. Let's go out without the bodyguards. So they went to a local McDonald's down the street.
Yeah.
And while they were there, they got served. They went to their table. They started eating their hamburgers and French fries. All of a sudden, this guy comes in, a stranger. He goes over to Elvis and he says, hey, you, I can't stand people that are trying to look like Elvis Presley. There's only one King of Rock and Roll. Give it up. So Elvis is like stunned. He can't believe the whole thing. And he says to Linda, tell him who I am. He says to the guy, I am Elvis Presley. I really am. I'm Elvis Presley. So Linda says, come on, Bob, cut it out. Cut the crap out. Right?
Oh, so
and,
she's playing along,
you know, she kept that going the whole time the stranger was there. So finally he left believing that Elvis was an impersonator.
I wouldn't categorize that as a great story, but it was a good story. Listen, Jim, you're a good sport to come on our show. We are going to continue to plug your book called Elvis Unknown Stories Behind the Legend by Jim Curtin.
Yeah.
With Renata Ginter.
Even though Jim kind of writes flowery stuff because he's still one of these Elvis lovers, he's got a whole bunch of the good stuff that we love about Elvis in there.
Lots of interesting stories, really, that nobody's ever known about, and we thought we knew everything about Elvis.
Thank you for coming on our show, Jim.
Thank you.
All right, bye-bye.
All right, now that we've shaken the two ankle weights, Jesus Christ.
God. Well, that's too bad about Christina Crawford.
Yeah. I mean, you know, we were trying to get some of the... But first of all, the story about... I thought it would take 3 hours to get to the story about her, you know, meeting Elvis.
And listen, I'm now reading in another one of our Elvis reference materials about Christina Crawford.
same story.
Yeah. All right, Jim Curtin writes that Elvis called her a bitch and pulled her by the hair.
Right. Right.
And here's what it says in the book Elvis, Aaron Presley. Christina Crawford came up to the house one night to see Joe Esposito. Elvis was smoking cigars, and every time he'd take one out, Joe would light it for him. Christina would reach out and grab it and break it. Elvis said, "Don't do that. That's not funny." So he picked up another one, and Joe went to light it again. She broke it again. Elvis said, "I've asked you nicely." She said, "He shouldn't have to light your cigars." Elvis said, "Look, he works for me, goddammit, and he knows when I get a cigar to light it for me." She did it a third time, and boy, oh boy, Elvis got mad. They got into a barrage of words. Elvis said, "Look, you bitch," and Christina threw a drink in his face. He stopped a minute, and he said, "I'm going to eliminate this problem." He got up and stepped on top of his 5x6 marble coffee table and grabbed her by her ponytail and dragged her across the goddamn room.
Ooh.
He kicked her in the ass as she was going out the door.
Wow.
It wasn't but a short time later she came back up and apologized. She said the reason she'd done it is because she resented seeing her mother treat everybody who worked for her the same way.
Man, oh man, that's interesting. Well, we were trying to get to that. Yeah. I would have liked to hear more about it.
Well, I don't think we'll ever have her on the show again.
No. How about that author? Is he coming back anytime soon?
I hope not, but I mean, he had some good stuff in his book, but he's another one of these guys that wants to talk about how much he loves Elvis.
Yeah, he's another one of these people that wants to talk out of both sides of his mouth.
At the same time, he's written, you know, about Elvis's ass blisters and everything, but he loves Elvis Presley.
And we always seem to get into it because we do have a problem with people that want to have it both ways.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Take one.
Quiet, please.
Recording.
Go again. I found a way to cook.
Take two.
I found a way to cook extra good. Come on over and try my crispy. It's entirely different, and yet it's just as tender and tasty. No, and it's just as finger-licking good. You see, I found a way to cook chicken deep down and get that real crispy crust that some folks like. And it's just as tender and juicy, and I'll get it now. I found a way to cook chicken deep down and get that crispy, real crispy chicken crust. Yet it's entirely different.
This will be Wild Lines 30, take one.
And now you have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Stop again.
He said cut it.
Go ahead.
And now you have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken to choose from. Yet tender and juicy. I said it.
That's right, cut it.
It's better.
Take two.
Colonel, if you read it. Okay, we're recording.
Now you have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken to choose from. My regular recipe.
Take three.
It's entirely different. It's entirely different. Whatever, but it's, now you have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken. Let me get that scratched off of there and quit looking at it.
Quiet, please.
That real crusty. Real what kind of damn crispy crust? It's really different. Now you can have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken to choose from. My regular recipe and my new extra crisp.
Crispy.
New extra crispy. I thought I said that. Now you have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken to choose from. It's entirely different. Yet every bit of finger licking good, you see. No, every bit of finger licking good. You see, I found a way to cook chicken deep down to get that real crispy crust some folks like. I better do that again, huh?
Yes.
All right. You don't want me to sing, do you, for Christ's sake?
We're rolling. This is the good one. Take five.
Most folks have heard about.
All right, that's good. Good, very nice.
That's why folks call it finger. That's why folks call it finger.
Sounds good.
That's why folks call it finger licking good. That's why folks call it finger licking good. That's why folks call it finger licking good.
Right, I'm not getting anywhere at this damn thing.
Okay, fine.
The Don and Mike Show.
You may experience gas with oily discharge, increased bowel movements, an urgent need to have them, and an inability to control them, particularly after meals containing more fat than recommended.
They are Icelandic cowboys.
in the West. Don and Mike.
The grandparents edition against the Whoopi coming right up. But first, we got to send lots of love out to Las Vegas.
Oh, yeah.
Where tonight, Robbie Knievel is going to jump all over. How many cars? He's doing something like 6 or 7 more cars than his dad did.
Yeah, is that which is that famous crash where you see all his bones breaking in slow motion?
Now, that's a whole show tonight on Fox, and I'm guessing that, I'm hoping that Robbie Knievel's jump is going to be the last thing, because we've got basketball practice tonight. That means I'm not going to make it home till like 8:45.
Now, it is live, right? It's a live, so, you know, Daredevil's live. That's the only way to watch him.
Isn't that something?
Hi, this is Evel Knievel. I'm here in Washington, D.C. with my son, Robbie. Robbie, would you ever listen to Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara?
No.
Neither would I.
Yeah, we had those two on the show a while ago.
Yes, we did. And
they're a piece of work, those two. Father and son. The apple does not fall far from the tree.
Absolutely. Evel, we believed, you know, a lot of pain when you break all those bones.
Sure.
So I believe he was heavily medicated when he dropped by to see us.
So what are the odds of Robbie Knievel wiping out tonight, which has to be what everybody is really hoping at Fox Television, right?
Sure. I think the rap on him is that he's a lot better than his dad. He's been a lot more successful, so he's got a shot at doing it, but it's also an awful long way to jump.
30 limos and a motorcycle.
And how far is that, Buzz?
I have no idea.
And his old man, that's the jump where he wiped out so bad, right?
Caesar's Palace.
Caesar's Palace?
Yeah, right near the fountain where he came down, and you see him, you know, and all his arms kind of looks like Elasto Man.
We should send some of our fans down there with big signs. You know, I wanted to mention that last night, my life is so pathetic, I was able to log on to Monday Nitro on TNT.
Yes.
And I saw that guy with the sign in the front row, "Hey, Don and Mike, kick ass."
So how did it, so he got some good TV time?
Well, but like every Goomba in the stands has a sign, you know, that either say, "I love Hulk Hogan," or
right,
"NWO, the New World Order."
So you did see our names in lights.
Yeah, I did. But as yet, we haven't gotten a call for that three-picture deal.
Hey, but we're in that B-movie with the lady with the see-through top, according to that other guy that called.
Mike, we are really happening. Let's go to Stan. Oh, let me check out the ages on the grandparents first. You got 65 and 69, 72.
You said 69.
80 and 82. Let's talk to that guy.
Boy, yeah.
Line 5, this is Richard. Hi, Richard.
Hey, how you doing, Radio Gods?
Doing great. Thank you for listening to our show on KFH Talk Radio in Wichita, Kansas.
Thank you.
Now, we're going to be calling your grandma and grandpa, Dean and Maxine.
Yeah.
Dean's 80, and Maxine is 82.
Actually, she's 80. He's 82.
Oh, we got it backwards?
Yeah, she's what?
What? She's what, Richard?
She's the younger one.
Okay, I got you. Richard, if you get it within 1 year, we will give you $50.
All right.
If you can predict within 1 year the last time that your wonderful grandma and grandpa did the nasty.
Well, they are a very odd couple, so I'm going to have to go with about 45 years.
45 years. So what year would that be? That would be like, hold on, let me get my pencil out here.
So we have to do our math right now. 45 years ago.
Three, that'd be 1953 is your last guess.
All right, that's my guess.
All right, Richard. So if she says 1952... 1953 or 1954,
Richard will be a big winner.
We will give you $50.
All right.
All right. Hold the line, Richard.
Time to call Dean and Maxine. Dean is 82, Maxine is 80, and Richard's guess was the last time they fulfilled their marital obligations, 53.
45 years ago. Hey, Richard, are you with us?
Yeah, I'm with you.
All right. Good luck to the Knievel man tonight.
Hello?
Yes, is this Maxine?
Oh, this is Mr. Cranford.
This is Dean.
Uh-huh.
Hey, Dean, hi. This is Don and Mike, and we're doing a national radio show right now, and we have your grandson, Richard, on the line with us.
Richard, say hi to your grandfather.
Hello, Grandpa.
Did you hear Richard, Dean?
Pardon?
Richard?
Why don't you speak up, Richard, please, and say hi to your grandfather.
Hello, Grandpa.
Hi.
Grandpa, Dean, do you have a grandson named Richard?
Yes, I do.
And he lives in Wichita, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he's on the line with us now, sir.
Uh-huh.
And we'd like to give you the chance to win some money for your grandson.
He's playing a game, and you have to help him here.
Have to do what?
Don't worry about have to. We're playing a little radio game right now.
We just need you to answer a question.
And if you match Richard's answer, he'll win some money.
Well, listen, Mike, we're doing too much talking here. Richard?
Yeah.
In your own homespun style, why don't you explain the game to Grandpa and then ask him the question?
Okay. The game they're playing is called Guess the Whoopee.
Call what?
Guess the Whoopee. And the question we're all asking is, when was the last time that you and Grandma, as I say, fulfilled your marital obligations?
You know, Dean.
Tell that America. Want to say that again?
Hey, Richard, you know your grandfather better than we do. You got to make that question a little clearer. Okay.
You can put it in layman's terms.
When was the last time you shared a romantic evening?
The last time you laid the pipe.
Huh?
Ricky. We don't want in on anything like
that. Uh-oh.
Is that Grandma?
Yeah, they think we're telemarketers.
Well, y'all, huh?
Richard, these are your grandparents, right?
Yeah, they are my grandparents.
Well, why don't you explain them? It's fun-loving and a chance for you to win a prize.
Yeah. Hey, are you there? Grandma.
Hey,
Grandma, it's Richard.
Years old and our health is real bad. And
it's Richard.
Please excuse us.
Maxine, we've got Richard, your grandson, here. Richard, will you say hi to your grandma?
Grandma, hi.
He's trying. Richard?
Hi.
Richard,
hi.
Can I ask you to speak up just a little bit?
Okay. Hello, it's me. It's Richard, Grandma.
Yeah.
Okay.
Richard?
Yeah, Richard.
We don't want in on
Hey, no, I'm your grandson, remember?
I don't care. We don't.
It's like living with Ronald Reagan.
We want out.
They want out, Richard.
Oh, they want out. Like you're out. Okay.
They want out.
Well, we'll be completely out and no strings attached.
What do you, ma'am? Can I just stop you for a second, no. Grandma?
No.
Grandma, this is. We're not selling anything. We're a couple of disc jockeys.
We're just playing a little radio game with Richard, and you're not obligated to come up with anything. We're having some fun with your grandson, Richard, who's right here with us right now.
And he's just answering a question about your life.
Well, we don't want to answer that question.
Okay.
That's private.
All right, that's fair enough.
Totally private.
Okay. Totally private. Richard, could you just tell me, was it in the early 50s?
Love you, Richard.
All right, love you.
Bye, hon.
All right.
Talk to you later.
Bye.
All right, that's a first.
Oh, yeah, I know.
There it is. They didn't want in on it, Richard.
I know.
And I think really, in a roundabout way, it was kind of like your fault.
Well, you didn't explain it to Grandma real good.
Well, I explained it to Grandpa, and I guess he didn't explain
it. No, you really didn't.
And Grandpa,
Richard,
just kind of handed the phone off to Grandma.
And Richard, are you close with your grandparents?
Hold on. Let me find him again. There he is. Hey, Richard?
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that they're just real old, man.
They're very old, and normally you can kind of talk to them,
Yeah.
It's not our job, really.
I can talk. I go over there and talk to them.
What do you mean you can go over there and talk to them?
Oh, I go over and talk to them all the time. They just probably thought we were all telemarketing.
But see, here's the thing, Richard. Why would they think we're telemarketing if it was their grandson on the line with us?
Because that's what I just got done doing for a living was telemarketing.
And did you hit your grandparents up quite a bit?
Oh, no.
Oh.
Never called them, but they knew I did it.
I think that she was offended by the question. I think she
got, yeah, she got
the
it at the very end. And when people say they don't want to answer, that's their prerogative.
Right.
Yeah.
But, it's just, we could have used a little help, Richard.
I tried to get in mine, but she was going on my
own. How are you at telemarketing?
Better than I am right now.
All right. Listen, Richard, you want a copy of Marilyn Manson's book, The Long Hard Road Out of Hell. And I'll send one to your grandma also.
All right.
Courtesy of HarperCollins and Crown Books.
All right.
Okay, thank you, Richard.
Uh-huh, thank you.
All right, hold on.
All right.
Hold on, we're just telling jokes here.
Oh, I get it. I get jokes.
We're just telling jokes here.
That was Richard, obviously paralyzed with fear.
All right, let's try somebody else.
Okay,
let's try...
We're talking to somebody else.
here's Stan, who's listening to our show in Reno on Sports Radio K-Play, KPLY.
Don and Mike.
Hey, Stan.
How are you guys?
Now, you got to love these names of Stan's grandparents.
Mm.
Ida Joe. And Bus.
Oh, it's great.
And that's Bus, like get on the bus?
Yeah, his real name is Stan, too, but he got that nickname in the Korean War, I guess.
So. Is he a big man?
Yeah, he's a pretty tall guy.
Okay.
Do you think you have a better relationship with your grandma and grandpa than the last guy did?
Yeah, I just hope they don't think I'm being mean to him, like the last guy, I hope they want to play.
It's amazing, Stan. You sound exactly like Richard.
I'm sorry, man. Hey, I'll try a different tone of voice. I'm talking like a radio guy.
Well, see, I think that if you have a good relationship with Grandma and Grandpa, you could probably smooth it over with them.
Yeah, yeah, it'll be okay.
And if you think that there's any chance that Grandma and Grandpa won't go along with this, maybe you shouldn't call us.
That's all right. I just hope I don't wake them up from a nap, and then I might catch them off guard. You know, they sleep a lot.
You know, it really does work best when the, you know, when the people call and they think that they, the grandparents or the parents will understand it.
Yeah, well, they should understand. They're not that old. They're,
all right.
They still run a
hold on, please.
Big
hold
ranch,
on.
So they're all
right. Hold oh, on. They hold run on. A ranch.
All right, here we go.
You know, this is kind of like family misfits call their grandparents.
They're not taking a dirt nap. Okay, Stan?
Yeah.
Here we go. Call them Ida, Joe, and Bus.
Hopefully we'll have more success than we had with Dean and Maxine.
With the Grandma and Grandpa edition.
Hello?
Of Guess the Whoopee. Is this Ida, Joe?
Who is this speaking, please?
Hi, this
hey,
is...
Hold on. Hey, Wesley.
Yeah.
Will you get Grandma?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks. Oh, Wesley. Hey, we're on the air, Wesley.
Dan.
I got to tell you that.
See, it's already more help than Richard gave us. So
he's obedient. He's already gone.
He's obedient.
And who is that?
Hello.
My nephew.
Hello, is this Ida Joe?
Yeah, it is.
Ida Joe, hi. This is Don Geronimo and Mike O'Maron. We're doing a national radio show right now, and we have your wonderful grandson, Stan, on the line with us. Say
hi,
hello.
Grandma.
Uh-huh.
How are you doing?
Good.
Okay, hope you don't kill me later.
Okay, I won't.
That's not a promising start, but I'm glad that she won't kill you.
No, I won't. I
want to explain the game to her, Don.
Yeah, Ida Joe. Oh, hold on a second. Hold on. Hey, Ida Joe, can you hold on, please?
You bet.
You know what?
What's happened?
I forgot to ask Stan the last time that he thought that they did it.
Oh,
oh, that's right. That's important. Stan, what's your guess?
1985.
85.
85.
Right, okay, okay, very right. Good. Now we'll talk to Ida Joe.
Okay, Ida Joe?
Yeah.
Now I hung up on Stan.
Oh, dear. Stan's gone.
Hold on,
dear.
Let me double check.
We really need Stan for this.
Hey, Stan?
Yeah, I'm back.
Oh, I got it.
Very good. We got Ida Joe and her grandson, Stan.
Ida Joe, you there? Okay, listen, we're playing a game called Guess the Whoopee.
Uh-huh.
And it's a chance for your grandson, Stan, to win $50 American, to put it, like, towards a savings account or something.
I'll give it to my grandma if I win.
Something responsible. That's nice, Stan.
Very nice of you, Stanley Stosh.
And we're playing a game called Guess the Whoopee. And, Stan, that's all the help I'm going to give. You have to ask your wonderful grandma the question yourself.
Grandma, I have to ask you a really important question, okay? It's no big deal. And no one needs to listen
okay.
to this show here anyway. Because we're too far away. Not that it's not a good show or anything.
What was that?
But
he's just handling it whatever way he sees fit.
All right, he's nervous.
But
no problem.
When was the last year you think that you and Grandpa had sex?
Way to go.
The year?
Yeah what year was
year.
It, Grandma?
Oh, my gosh, so many years ago, I don't remember. Oh, I don't know. Probably, gee, 10 years ago.
What would that be, Grandma?
That would be 89.
No, 10 years ago would be 87.
Oh. No, 10 years ago would be 88.
That's all right, yeah.
Either way, Stan, I'm sorry, that's 3 years away from your guess.
Ida Joe, Stan guessed 1985.
Oh, okay.
But that's okay.
But I wouldn't know either.
Grandma, you're a good sport.
You are, Ida Joe, you're wonderful.
Okay.
Ida Joe, listen, I'm going to send you and your grandson each a copy of Marilyn Manson's book, The Long, Hard Road Out of Hell, courtesy of HarperCollins and Crown Books.
Okay.
Okay?
You bet.
All right, Donna Mike, thanks.
Wonderful.
Uh-huh.
All right, thank you. Now, both you guys, stay on the line for a second.
I am. Okay.
Hold on. All right. I don't even want to hear their private conversation now.
Our free book arrived, Bus.
All right, we'll come back. You know, we'll try this with one more couple.
Very good.
See if we get a winner. But we come right back. Here is Tara. Tara, who's going to be the last one to try and guess the Whoopee today. We've had no winners thus far. The first grandma would not participate in the game, and the second grandma was a couple of years off.
Yeah, just very close, though. Very close. She didn't really remember herself.
Is this Tara?
Yeah.
Hi, and you are listening to us on WJFK, right?
Yes.
In Baltimore?
Yes. Well, yeah.
Beautiful.
Close to Baltimore.
Calling mom and dad, rather grandma and grandpa now, and huh? They are Pip. And Ken, how old is Pip?
I think she's 66, but she could be 65.
Is she a Pip?
She's actually a Lolita.
A Lolita?
Her name is Lolita, but everyone calls her Pip.
Lolita.
And what about Ken? How old is Ken?
Ken is 70.
Okay, now, your grandma and grandpa, I know you probably haven't thought a lot about their sex life.
And not too much.
But now that you have noodled it through, at least for a couple of seconds, when is the last time that you think your grandma and grandpa got up on a sink?
And that is the way you think of it now. Ever since that little occasion of intercourse.
That's a really nasty visual.
Should have seen it.
My uncle is 30, so I'm going to say 68.
So 1968 is your guess?
Yeah.
So you think the last time that they had sex was when they conceived your uncle?
Yep.
Okay.
They're not real active.
All right, hold the line, please, Tara. Let me call them up here.
68. And,
okay.
Richard had you beat with Dean and Maxine. He said 53, but 68 is going back a long time, too.
That's Hubert H. Humphrey time. 68, that's Batman was still on
TV.
Hello, is this Pip?
Yes, it is.
Hey, Pip, this is Don Geronimo, Mike O'Mara. We're doing a national radio show right now. And we have your granddaughter, Tara, on the line with us. Or is it Tara? Which is it, Tara?
Tara.
Tara, go ahead and say hi to your grandmother.
Hi, Nan.
Hi, Pooper Scooper.
To kill you.
Listen, Pip.
Yes.
We're going to give Pooper Scooper the chance to win $50 here.
Okay.
We're playing a game on our show called Guess the Whoopee. And, well, Tara, listen, I'm going to let you take it over here with your grandma now.
Okay, Nan.
Yeah.
Think really hard. I know you have trouble remembering even yesterday.
Yeah.
The last time that you and Pop had sex. What year was it?
That's why we called the game Guess the Whoopee, Pip, and now you have to guess.
Ah.
Figure it out.
Well.
What year would that have been, Pip?
Let me see. 1962.
Oh!
So very close.
Mike is 30. How could that happen? You had to have done it in 68.
Hey, Grandma, she's got you there.
Yes, you do.
Hey, would you like to modify your story, Pip?
Yeah, I think that was 68.
68. All right.
Listen, we'll give it to you.
Oh, really, if it's been that period of inactivity deserves a reward.
We'll give it to you. Oh, boy. Hey, Tara, we're going to give you $50.
Great.
And we're going to send you and your grandma both a copy of Marilyn Manson's book, The Long, Hard Road Out of Hell.
Great.
Huh.
And that's from HarperCollins and Crown Books.
Yeah.
Grandma, I think you'll really like the pictures in this book.
Yeah, they're fantastic.
Sure, I will.
And you'll enjoy it too, Pooper Scooper.
Great, I can't wait.
All right, so the answer was 62, but we think it was really 68.
That's right.
Since that's when the uncle was born.
That's
was that,
right.
Pip, was that the last time that you had relations right after?
Absolutely. Did I lie to you?
Absolutely. And Pip?
That's really sad, man.
I'm a very sad person. Now you know why.
All right, thank you, Tara, Pooper Scooper. And thank you, Pip.
Okay.
All right, hold the line.
Thank you.
Kids, stay right there, and we'll be back.
Okay.
And now we'll eavesdrop. This time we'll eavesdrop.
That's great. I was hoping you would answer and not Pop.
Well, here I am. That's wild. Where are you at?
I'm in the car.
Oh, okay.
It's you know, wild. Mom and Tom listen to this radio show.
Do they really?
Yeah. I don't know if they're listening or not.
That is funny.
I figured you'd appreciate that.
Oh, that's pretty good. You don't mind we were listening, do you?
Yeah, we were eavesdropping. Sorry about that, you guys.
All right, hold the line.
If I would have known.
Hold the line, kid.
Okay.
Hold on. This time, really, hold on. Well, all right, there's a big wiener to end the show.
That is a good winner. I like that.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
I am here to learn about radio.
Oh, yeah?
The radio. I am here to learn about radio.
Oh, yeah?
The radio.
Hey,
I am here to learn about radio.
Oh, yeah?
The radio. I am here to learn about radio.
Well, it's not Don and Mike. Donald B. Giraffa. Mike O'Mara. Donald B. Giraffa. Mike O'Mara. Donald B. Giraffa. Mike O'Mara. Donald B. Giraffa.
And the key is here.
Donald B. Giraffa. Mike O'Mara. Mike O'Mara, Donald B. Geronimo, Mike O'Mara.
That was a joke.
Donald B. Geronimo, you're a virgin, huh? I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan.
Hey, now.
Hey, that's clever.
Oh, yeah?
I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan.
Hey, now.
Of sex.
That'll be fun.
Don and Mike. I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan.
Hey, now.
Hey, that's clever.
Oh, yeah?
I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan.
Of healthy American interest in sex.
Not that.
We're white.
Hey, now.
We're Catholic.
And we are
sick about it.
Sick about it. Not that.
We're white.
Hey, now.
We're Catholic.
And we are sick about it.
We're white.
Hey, now.
We're Catholic.
And we are
sick about it.
Sick about it. Not that.
We're white.
Oh, yeah.
We're Catholic.
And we are
sick
$5
minimum.
Let me tell you something. Ooh, we're excited today. We still got
something that can't throw up.
Oh, yeah? Let me tell you something. Ooh, we're excited today. We still got $1,000
minimum.
Let me tell you something. Ooh, we're excited today. We still got something that can't throw up.
All right.
Take three. It's entirely different. It's entirely different. But every bit. Now you have yourself. Now you have two kinds of Kentucky Fried Chicken. Let me get that scratch off there. Come on, Apple.
From the heart of my bottom. Ooh, we're excited today.
Mm-hmm. You know.
From the heart of my bottom. We still got Don and Mike.
I'm a big fan.
From the heart of my bottom. Ooh, we're excited today.
Mm-hmm. You know.
From the heart of my bottom, we still got Don in mind.
I'm a big fan.
Stablack, the Charlie interview coming up today.
Good.
Also,
good.
Remind we've got Jerry Lewis's acceptance speech from the American Comedy Awards the other night.
All right.
The highlight of which is when he says, the key, is it the third key, Rob? The third key to being a successful comedian, don't take yourself too seriously.
Jerry, way to go. Jerry being serious about Jerry.
But first, let me get wait and talk about the desks. Did you know that there's a huge problem upstairs with the desks?
Oh, really?
It doesn't affect anybody on this show, but everybody else upstairs. How do I explain this? We're in a building that we lease space from.
That's right.
And the station has been knocking down walls and making new offices.
Yeah, they're remodeling the whole building.
Okay, so everybody is now set where they're going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Except the company that we lease from came back today and said, listen, we want our desks back. And as it turns out, I don't know if we being CBS,
sure,
if we stole the desks,
yeah,
or if we thought that they came as part of the deal,
yeah.
But today, the people from the other company came in and took a bunch of desks back, including the desk of General Manager Ken Stevens.
Oh,
wow. Office manager, Miss Bobby.
Just came in and took them out.
Yeah, and who else, Rob?
I believe also the entire Liddy staff lost their desk. What was said to me was that Mr. Liddy's secretary said, I'm not having a very good day because I've been told I have to return my desk by 12 noon.
Boy, so
how
was
about that?
How did this little thing
don't know.
Wow.
Don't know. Let me call Bobby.
Man, it's always something.
Well, no matter what they're taking, keep their hands off those flesh-tone couches.
Yeah.
Oh, that stuff's ours. Hey, Miss Bobby.
Hi.
Did you hear that?
How are you?
That's the real Miss Bobby right there.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I was just listening to you.
Hey, they took your desk away, huh?
Yeah.
So are you sitting Indian style on the floor now?
Sitting on the floor with a bunch of boxes.
Boy, how did this happen so quick, Miss Bobby?
It's kind of a really long story.
I bet it really pissed you off, didn't it?
I was not a happy camper.
I didn't think so.
They just came in and hauled people's desks out, huh?
Well, it was a kind of they're borrowing the new landlord's desk, and we were borrowing theirs until the transition and the reconstruction was finished. But they decided they wanted them right now.
So they took Ken's desk, too?
I don't know if they took Ken's.
Yeah. You might want to look around the corner and see if they took his desk. You know.
Oh, gosh.
Who else did it happen to, Bobby? Any of the salespeople?
No. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's too bad.
Now, did you stand your ground, like stand at the front door and try to block the way, like George Wallace did when he was trying to, you know, keep integration out?
I don't think it's quite over yet.
Oh, really?
I see that. That's right.
Yeah.
Well, if you get that desk back, or maybe you already did this. You should do what Mike and I do to all of our property.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing a bear does.
It makes sure that it is yours forever.
We urinate all over all of our property.
It's a great way to really make sure that something belongs to you.
It's the law of the jungle.
Sounds like a good idea to me.
Yeah, you might want to memo the rest of the staff, too, if they're ever thinking about taking anything out of our office.
Yeah.
Tell them that everything is covered with our urine.
I'll keep that in mind.
All right, Bobby.
Thanks.
Bye-bye. Very mellow right there, but inside, she's ready to explode, man.
And what I thought was really good is that you were nice enough to go up before the furniture was in there and just go to the four corners of the office and make sure that that's our office. Nobody can use that now.
They got our territory. All right, more on that topic tomorrow when Ken Stevens comes into the office and finds out he doesn't have a desk.
Clueless Ken will be arriving trying to find out, hey, where's my desk?
How long do you think it'll take him to sit in there before he figures out they took his desk?
At least, if they didn't take his chair, probably 2 or 3 hours. It's like, this seems really irregular.
Okay, here's a letter that I've been holding on to most of this week that I wanted to read.
Oh, good.
And there's a phone number that comes with it.
Okay.
A letter from a guy addressed as Jesus H. Christ. Okay, we get a lot of kooky mail, but this is way up there.
Good.
Okay. Dearest Don and Mike, I've heard you mention me on your show. Don, you were close in describing my childhood. My dad, Joseph, and my mom, Mary, were pretty cool. But my stepdad, God, was very strict. You see, Don, like you, I was adopted. And when I would bring home my report card and it wouldn't be all A's, he would get pissed. Damn it, Jesus. You should have gotten an A in history. Hell, I invented it. I guess that's God talking to Jesus.
Sure, same thing in a lot of religions.
And then there was the time he caught Moses and I smoking behind Noah's boat.
Uh-oh.
He sent Moses up to the mountains and made him write a bunch of rules and stuff. He would also rag on me about my appearance.
This is Jesus writing this letter.
Damn it, Jesus. Cut your hair. Shave your beard. Damn it, Jesus, you look like crap. I remember when Ramses and I went to the Olympics in Rome.
Wow.
We were watching the games. Well, one of the players blew out his knee. Not bad, hopefully. We started laughing, and one of the coaches said we were sick in the head.
There you go.
And we should have our asses thrown right out of the Coliseum. At home, he was a real pain. He would say stuff like, Jesus, clean your plate. You never know. This might be your last supper.
Oh, man.
Or, Jesus, go clean the garage. Damn, this place is a dump. He made me write this big book. Maybe you've heard of it. It's called the Bible. I was one verse short, but he wrote it for me.
Good.
The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the inequities of the selfish.
Hey, I didn't know that Jesus watched Pulp Fiction.
Wow. And the tyranny of evil men. Blessed is he who in the name of charity and goodwill shepherds the weak through the valley of darkness. For he is truly his brother's keeper.
Boy.
And the finder of lost children.
He's really giving us the A material here.
Yeah. I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. Mm-hmm. You will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
Boom, 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 boom.
Don, don't worry about your parking spot in front of my dad's house. That'll be my parking spot at church.
There you go.
It's yours forever. If anybody parks there, I will have them towed. Mike, my dad says you haven't been by since you were married.
Oh, dear.
Dad says skip one golf game on Sunday or you'll be sorry.
Oh, no.
Buzz.
Yes?
My dad listens to your radio show on Sunday.
Oh, wow, cool.
He loves it.
Well, hey, good.
Keep up the good work. Well, guys, I have to go. I have a terrible headache.
That's it?
Yeah. I will be watching for your next Las Vegas-style show.
Yeah.
Sincerely, Jesus H. Christ.
Oh, my God.
And then there's a phone number.
Well, let's call Jesus.
All right, let's call the J-Man.
A little uncomfortable. I'm the only one that got threatened there. I didn't know he could have people towed.
Hey, that'd be great. Jesus comes up in a tow truck.
Yeah. Sorry. There's nothing I can do about it. Go down to the pound.
Stand and go, Jesus. And he goes, yes, I'm here to tow your car.
I'm not taking it off the hook. Does Jesus have a receptionist?
I guess. Hello?
Oh, dear.
Hello, Jesus?
It's interesting. Yes. There's a child there.
Jesus?
Oh, I don't think Jesus would have a lame answering machine like this. It's one of the cheap ones. I think he'd have voicemail.
Jesus?
There it is.
Hey, J-Man.
Hi, Jesus.
Jesus Christ.
God and Mike calling.
We just wanted a chance to talk to Jesus Christ.
That was an incredible letter that you wrote, Jesus.
Yeah, thanks.
Listen, stay in touch.
And I'll try to cut down on the golf.
And thanks about towing. That's cool.
You're all right. You're just all right with me, Jesus.
Appreciate it.
See you Sunday.
Hope your headache gets better. Bye, Jesus.
Oh, man. Well, we have a friend there. What a friend we have.
What is that song?
What a friend we have in Jesus.
And he listens to our show.
Yeah, and he goes to Las Vegas-style shows.
Oh, I wish we had a tape like that. Hello. This is Jesus Christ. I never listen to the Don and Mike show. Would that be a great tape?
Oh, it'd be our greatest tape. Our greatest tape ever. Jesus.
Hello. This is Jesus Christ. Don and Mike kick ass.
Oh, man, we treasure that one. Keep that one under lock and key.
Hello. This is Jesus Christ. Nice.
Boy, where do our boots go?
Jesus. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
keynote speakers at the BM Banquet, Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Hello, Don and Mike Show. Hello.
Speak to us.
You know, we can't even take calls. I forgot we got the ladies here. Hello.
The ladies and their men.
Don and Mike. You know, I thought that there was a relevant call on one of these lines. There was a lady that wants to be the third.
Lady.
Oh, you're
Don
not the lady?
Mike. Don and Mike, Radio Gods.
I guess her car phone gave up. Anyway, there's a third
wheel
on her way down here now. She was just getting off the Beltway, so to speak.
Oh, the one that's going to, the little contest you guys got going on, or a game show or something?
It's just an experiment, sir.
Oh, yeah, an experiment. Anyways, you guys forgot Dan Fogelberg, but I wanted you guys to rate a girl for me.
Okay.
Shania Twain.
Bueno Arbusto. I give her,
what are you
nice.
What are you
nice. Boosh.
I give Shania Twain, who kind of reminds me of Sheena Easton.
Right.
Who's a real tart herself. I give Shania Twain 7.6.
Give her an 8.5.
Wow.
Yeah, I've always always thought she's very, very strong.
She has a country singer ass.
Yes. Is she,
she's got a little Tammy Wynette ass.
You think she's large in the derriere?
Just a little bit.
I think just large enough. I good, strong 8.5.
And I go, more cushion for the pushing. But look at her video, the way that they shoot Shania Twain videos.
Really?
It's very much done from the knees up, and a lot of the stuff with drapes, where she's kind of dancing. Don't get me wrong.
You know, it reminds me of a thing I saw.
I give her a 7.6.
A repeat of In Living Color when they were doing a takeoff on a Paula Abdul video.
Oh.
Remember when she had those videos for a number of years where the camera was all wide, and it was like all stretched and stuff, and they did it with her. It was great. What do you give her?
Give her an 8.
An 8.
Yeah. There you go, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I guess the third party hung up. Rob, would you bring in, bring in first Lynn.
Lynn and her husband, or right. her boyfriend.
Let's meet Lynn, who was the gal that sent us a fax yesterday and said, Donna Mike, I've thought about a lesbian bisexual relationship.
That's correct. There's electricity. Can you feel that electricity in the studio?
If you could find me a gal. And we said, of course, we'll find you the gal, and our office is open.
Sure.
We got new carpeting we've laid down and the flesh-colored couches. Here
All right.
we go.
Here comes the boyfriend.
Hey. Bueno Arbusto.
Hey, it's Ross from Friends.
Hey.
All right.
Hi, my friends.
Hi there. Oh, hello.
Look how red you is.
How you doing, guys?
Is that a sunburn you have, Lynn, or are you embarrassed?
A little bit of both.
Wow, she's really red.
Boy, you sold yourself short with the Melissa Gilbert thing. Now, you're much prettier than Melissa Gilbert.
Yeah, you're pretty hot. You're pretty hot.
Absolutely.
Blonde hair. I don't want to say this is getting me in trouble with my wife, so Mike, why don't you describe Lynn?
She's got long, lovely blonde hair. She's got a lovely tan, a beautiful figure.
Oh, you know how you know she's good looking? Look what Buzz just did with his lights.
Cut the glare.
Whenever there's a good looking woman in here, Buzz dims his lights.
So here you are, Lynn. You initiated all this. You brought your boyfriend with you. How do you step up to the microphone? How do you feel now?
Very nervous.
Very nervous. Have you had a chance to meet our other couple?
Yes.
Are you wearing underwear?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You ready for the experiment?
Possibly.
Uh-oh. What do you mean, possibly?
No offense intended, but even with a woman, there'd have to be some physical attraction.
Well, all right, let's bring in the gal that came by. That's what happens when you have an experiment. Okay, let's see. Maybe she can win you over.
Yeah,
with her personality.
We'll see. But you know, two beautiful people can have that problem.
What's wrong with her is not the proper.
Well, we're gonna get this worked out. We'll figure out what's going on.
Didn't you like? That's why you two shouldn't have met before the show. What?
Physical attributes.
Physical attributes, all right.
Like what?
Okay, here we go.
Hi.
Hi. All righty. All right, we have the other couple in here. Right. Okay.
Okay, now this is going to be an awkward moment.
This is very awkward.
It is.
And we forget, your name is?
Melanie.
Melanie. All right, and you guys have already met. All right, this is one of the most awkward moments.
Very awkward.
We have had on this show.
Now, Melanie, you're willing to try to help Lynn?
Yes.
Yes. Oh, could you step closer? Can both girls step closer to the microphone?
Yeah. Everybody seems to want to be actually backing out of the studio altogether right now.
Now, stand a little closer.
Yeah, just
stand closer.
All right. There we go.
First appearances can be deceiving.
Mm-hmm.
How you girls doing?
Fine. All right.
Fine. Okay, Lynn. What's your name?
Melanie.
I'm sorry, I forgot.
Melanie. Now, Melanie, Lynn has said that you don't have a physical attraction to Melanie. Is that the deal?
Yes.
Now, Melanie, do you have...
What if you closed your eyes, Lynn?
Can't do that with men. I don't think I could do it here.
Melanie, do you have a physical attraction to Lynn?
Well, she's not bad looking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no kidding.
Did somebody fart? One of you, I'm sorry, I have to ask. Did anybody break wind?
Was it you, Lynn?
No.
No, not a chance.
Any of the boyfriends? You, sir, over there looking off into the space over there?
Rob is a little nervous, Mike. That could be what it
Rob,
is.
I
believe I've identified it as Rob Spiewak.
Okay, I'm sorry. I simply had to ask.
And it crept out right in the middle of our awkward moment there.
Yes, it did. It was. It was very, very embarrassing.
Now, she is willing to open her arms, but open even more than her arms to you.
That's right.
In an effort to show you what the lesbian lifestyle is all about, Lynn.
It's kind of your call now, Lynn. You know, it's your thing.
Well, like I said before, even with men, you have to have a physical attraction. And
oh, you're cold.
I don't mean to be cold, but there has to be some type of spark
of
interest.
Cold.
Would you like to weigh in on this, boyfriend, and help your girlfriend out here at all?
Yeah, come on, Ross from Friends. Step up to the microphone. Step up here, my friend.
She has it all covered. There's no need for me to...
And I think, Ross, I think it was you that dropped the beef chip, frankly.
I
don't know, man.
You think so? Right. Well, listen, do you guys want to... So what you're telling me is that there's no way?
So you're telling us there's no chance?
No chance?
There's no physical attraction. Sorry.
No way.
Okay.
Bummer. Hey, where's Jimmy's girlfriend? Did she say she was on the way
She's
down?
She's on her way down, Mike. How about both of you? We'll put each of you in a separate waiting room, and we'll see if we can get a partner.
That's a great idea.
For each of you. If you'd be interested, Melissa.
Would you be in?
Melanie.
Would you?
Sorry, I got to write that down.
Melanie, would that be cool with you?
Well,
Melanie.
You got a time commitment?
Yes. Actually, we're going to a concert tonight.
Oh, you are?
Yes.
Lynn, would that be all right with you if we had you wait for maybe the right person to come along?
That's fine with me.
Look at the boyfriend. Yeah.
No, wait. Hold on. I want to talk to Melanie's boyfriend. What are you whispering? Or is that your husband? Step up, sir. Step up, Mr. Melanie. Hello, my friend.
Hey.
Hi. What are you whispering over there to your wife?
We were just saying that, if things fell through today, that the two of us would certainly go up and take care of your couch for you.
Well, if you would like to go up and use our office.
It's just a thing I have about being naked in your presence.
Well, we wouldn't
be the Thanksgiving dinner, and it just, you know, it carries.
Oh, you mean that because we've seen you naked one time.
Yeah.
You feel comfortable? Sure, well, go ahead. Knock yourselves out.
Really?
Yeah.
Hey, can I say hi to a few people that I work with?
Sure.
They all know what we're up to today.
Right. Okay.
Sure.
Go ahead.
I got to say hi to Jeannie and Ryan and Guffy. This is your quota for the day, pal.
All right, great. Have fun in our office.
Oh, go on up.
Okay.
Don't touch the desk.
Bye-bye.
Stay on the couches.
See you later.
Please.
Goodbye.
You're a cold-hearted woman, Liz. God damn it, you're cold. You're so cold. That woman wanted you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you got balls.
That is, that's good.
It doesn't hurt to be honest.
It doesn't hurt to be honest.
Oh, now he pipes in. Now that the fat people have left the room.
Oh.
Now he's full with the mouth.
You said it.
You know, though, when you examine the logic of the situation, I understand Lynn 1,000%. I understand where she's coming from.
I think she's cold.
I know you're disappointed.
Cold. A woman like that would probably try harder to please you.
But hopefully you'll find one of your listeners who would be interested in coming in and taking care of the matter.
I like the fact that you're still interested, Lynn.
Right.
I really do.
Okay, well, Lynn, go on back to the back room. And now we've really got to work on a description of Lynn.
Yeah.
Well, I think, no, you know what? That's wrong. We've already articulated the fact that Lynn's a hottie.
She's a bit of a hottie, yes.
Lynn, what are your strict requirements?
Just someone.
I'd hate for you to break another girl's heart.
Do you want someone? You had mentioned yesterday that you want someone with similar attributes to you.
Yes.
Yeah. So you want another hottie to come down?
Well,
here.
Not necessarily a hottie, but not someone that I'd go at.
Oh, God damn it. So is that what you did? Is that what you did? Kind of?
Okay. All right. Real good.
Okay.
Real nice.
All right. All right, we'll go on in the back room.
Okay.
And thanks, and we will try our hardest to find you a match before the end of the show today.
Meanwhile, Melanie and husband...
Oh, yeah, let's call up to our office.
...are on their way up to the office.
Hey, Robbie?
What's our office phone number?
I don't know.
I could have looked it up.
And I'll tell you something, Don, when it got really tense in here, somebody, and it wasn't, believe me, because I know all you guys.
Thank you, Mike.
Okay, yeah, it was a foreign one, you think.
Yeah, it was something.
Think that was Ross from Friends?
I believe it was Ross from Friends. Hmm.
Did they bring her up to the office?
You think it was Melanie, Rob?
God. I mean, she suffered enough.
Amen,
Buzz. He just mouthed.
Amen.
Oh! He mouthed
Melanie. How would you feel if you were being rejected?
No, no.
I bet you'd have a big beefer, too. You're standing right there ready to, you know, open yourself up to somebody.
And then it's total rejection, and then it's, you know.
And you're sitting there, and you go, oh.
God. She's so cold.
Oh,
my God.
I'll show her.
Well, I don't know what's happening. That's the time. Oh, you know what? I know what it is.
Oh, it doesn't ring.
The ringer on our goddamn phone doesn't work.
Oh. It doesn't ring. The antiquated 1910 phone that we have.
Listen, during the set, we'll run upstairs and tell them to call us here.
Nah.
Because the only way that they're going to know the phone is ringing is if they see the little light going on.
Yeah. But boy, it's going to be steamy in that office.
Hold on, here they are. Hello.
Hello.
Hey, hi, Charlie.
It really doesn't ring. I thought you were just ignoring me when I'd call you.
No, I told you we need a new telephone. just the light goes on.
The ringer dingy thing doesn't work.
I'll get on that.
Now, how are things for Melanie and her husband?
They're fine. You want to speak with them?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Please.
Hey.
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 Hey, nice office.
Thanks.
Pretty sweet. I like the Mr. Clean stand-up. That's
the nicest office we've ever had.
So the day's not going to be a total loss for you.
No, I think we're going to try this with the radio in the background, since you guys don't think anybody can concentrate with the show on.
Oh, that's a nice experiment.
I'm afraid we're going to have to turn Mr. Clean around. He's giving me the heebie-jeebies, though.
Maybe you might want to turn the radio off.
Nah, we can do it.
Well,
come on, we got two kids and a dog, man. We could, you know, through a hurricane, for Christ's sake.
All right. Okay. I would hate for you to be in the middle of something, and then if Lynn came back in, you know Lynn.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's all right.
Well, more power to you guys.
Okay.
Enjoy yourselves.
Listen, how much time do you think you'll need?
Oh, I don't know. How much time, man?
It's 5:28 right now.
Half an hour or so.
All right, listen, we'll call you back at 6.
Okay.
Okay.
Good deal.
Bye-bye. Stay off the desk, please.
Okay.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm.
But feel free to enjoy my couch.
And there's a beautiful woman in the next room named Lynn.
Yes, she is.
Who
yeah.
wants to explore her lesbian side right upstairs in our office.
She is looking for an equally attractive woman.
You simply have to come by Dynamite World Broadcast Headquarters today.
And be prepared to be rejected by Lynn.
Hello.
Hey.
Hey, Dynamite Show.
Listen, I want to tell you guys, I agree with Lynn. That's got to be the coolest thing, to live out your fantasy and be with another girl. God damn it, she should be with one that she finds hot. I don't blame her.
Well, all right. Settle down. Don't set your bra on fire or anything.
No need to get upset. Come on, now we understand where you're coming from.
Hey, she's got balls.
She sure does.
Yes, she does. That took a lot of courage.
That was an awkward moment,
yeah,
man.
Yeah,
that was a really awkward moment. I loved it. It was a great moment.
But, of course, when you're faced with a totally desperate situation, sometimes that makes us all courageous.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hi.
And it gives some of us bad gas.
Yes, yeah. Who's somebody? One of the four magicians in here.
There is no physical attraction.
Oh, I'm so rejected.
Hello.
Hello.
Don and Mike.
How are you guys?
Great.
I'm heading up 66 miles one way to my job, and you guys keep me awake. This is the funniest show you all have had.
Well, for all those people in the other lane coming in your direction, I'd like to say thank you.
This is the absolutely. I feel sorry for Melanie, but God knows this is the funniest show you guys have.
Right, we all feel sorry for Melanie, but we're getting a great show out of it. That's
absolutely.
Right.
And I'd like to point out that as of this moment, Melanie's having sex.
Well, I heard that as well, but some of the folks on my job, they're amazed that I listen. But I told them. 66 miles is the only way I can stay awake, and it is funny.
Right on, my friend.
All right, we'll talk to you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And Monday, when I come back to the office, I'm bringing everybody a big box of clean shower.
There's no physical attraction.
Oh.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike.
Yeah.
I want to know, what does Lynn look like?
Lynn is a highly attractive woman.
Yes, she's got blonde hair, she's got tan blue eyes, nice smile, beautiful body.
She does.
Yeah.
And it has to be at the studio.
Yes. Hurry. What are you wasting time on the telephone
call
for?
Me.
call you. Oh, forget it. No. We're her pimp.
Yeah.
Talk to us.
Nobody will be watching you if that's what you're worried about.
Oh, that you're not.
No, we send them
but
up.
But I can't make it down there in time.
All right, goodbye.
Well, we are not going to beg.
Goodbye. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike.
Hey, Bobby.
Just want you to know the lights are low, the curtains are drawn, and I've got my big beats down in the middle of the floor.
I know. We're providing a service today for a lot of guys.
Thank you very, very much from all of us guys with the lights low.
All righty then.
All right. Now I'm starting to get embarrassed.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
You know what happens when he gets embarrassed.
Goodbye.
Oh.
We got to do a quick break. We will sort this out, and we come right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show. When in Los Angeles, they dine at Vivian's. Don and Mike.
Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, how's it going? This is Sean in Reno. First time caller, long time listener.
Thank you, my friend.
I've been enjoying the hell out of your show today.
Well,
got to tell you, I got a take on the Frida bashers out there that tie in with the whole thing.
What?
The Frida bashers out there.
Right. Oh, the Frida bashers.
The Frida bashers, yeah. It's
oh, my God. Hold on. Hold on a second.
Hold it.
Oh, what? My God.
Good, bad?
If it's possible... Lynn has been topped.
Really?
Lynn probably will be topped.
Wow.
Okay, now let me have it.
By the tomato that's walking in right now.
Okay,
a little Dallas, Dallas, Texas lady.
Yeah, a cheerleader cast off.
Mm-hmm.
A sloppy second from the Dallas Cowboys cheerleader. She didn't make the team.
Mm, fantastic. I know Ross is going to be thrilled.
Oh, man.
Ross, our boyfriend in the next room.
Oh, right.
Yes.
I almost forgot. See?
I didn't see her yet. I didn't see her. Are they bringing her right in?
Yeah, they are.
Hey, right.
What did you want to say?
I just think that everybody out there that's been bashing on Frida, they ought to turn the lights down real low today.
Yeah.
Take a good listen to your show.
I'm not even listening
while they're
to
sitting there.
Yeah, no, we're just waiting for
the
elements later to come in.
And a cigarette burns in their V-neck T-shirts.
Okay, I'm glad you respect my wife. Thank you. I do, too. She's a great lady. Now I got to go look at the next lesbian. Bye-bye.
All right. Here we go.
Can I talk to her?
And Bye-bye. Here she comes.
Yeah, see?
Hi.
Look at her.
Hello
Hi.
There.
How are you guys?
Wow.
Look at her.
Nice to put names with faces.
Great.
Now, so.
Don't you look like a Miss Dallas?
It's hard for me to mask that from what I understand.
So you were listening to the show and you just had to come down.
Exactly. Actually, I just pulled up, listened to it the whole way here and was waiting on the connection between... Mm-hmm.
And you're a lesbian or are you bisexual?
No, I don't even know. I'd call myself bisexual, but I have... definite attraction to women, and fortunately, I've been dating the same guy for several years, and he's real open to that sort of thing.
Okay.
So when I decided to experiment, he was like, go off, go ahead, have a good time.
Now you're gonna better than we could have ever anticipated.
Now you're going to see something a little happier than what happened last hour.
I believe so. Now, you have not had a chance to meet Lynn yet, have you?
You know, actually, I saw her when I came in, and we just briefly, I shook her hand a second ago,
but
we didn't get to speak.
All right, okay.
Yeah. I bet she won't turn you down.
No way.
Who's the celebrity that you think you most resemble?
You know what? When I was younger in high school, people told me that I looked like Marla Maples, but now that I'm older, they say I look like Courtney Thorne Smith. I don't see that.
Uh-huh.
You
I
look
do.
There, so I do. Absolutely.
Okay. I do. Mommy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mommy.
Bad boy.
All right, let's bring in Lynn. And let's let these two meet face-to-face.
This is going to be a wonderful meeting, and I know that Lynn's boyfriend is certainly going to enjoy himself, too.
And then let the fun begin.
All right.
Well, we got to make sure the other couple's done with our office.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
Oh, it's after six.
Did they really go up there?
Yeah, they did. Yeah.
Oh, that's kind of scary.
There's been a lot worse up there than now. Look at how happy Lynn is now.
Here comes Lynn. Look at that smile.
Look at this. Oh, wow. Like Tiffin Cousins.
She has a nice smile. She does have a nice smile.
And I think, you know, I'm getting the dynamic here that, Lynn, what you wanted was somebody with maybe a little more experience in this type of thing, and I think you've found the right person here.
I believe y'all both that we found the right person.
All right, well, let's see if there's any karma. How about you two kiss?
Oh, right now. I thought you were going to ask more background questions.
No, come
first.
On, kiss. Just kiss.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see if there's anything between you.
Just a little get acquainted kiss. Doesn't have to be anything.
I would be more than happy to do this, but I thought that we might want to, like, you know.
Well, you can do that later. Let's just see if there's any chemistry here. Just a tiny little peck.
Just a small little peck.
Just a little
kiss. I can do a small peck.
Little kiss. Now, I saw Miss Dallas Cowboy with the mouth that was a little more open.
Well, now, Miss Dallas, what is your first name again? What is your Miss Dallas?
My name is Tammy.
I saw Tammy's mouth open a little bit, and Lynn, you didn't open your mouth back, did you?
She's nervous. This is a scary thing.
Oh, give her another kiss. Walk her through this.
Tammy is taking charge here.
Well, walk her through this, Tammy. Give her another kiss. You ever kissed a woman before, Lynn? God.
Wow. You didn't answer that question, though.
What's that?
What question?
Have you ever kissed a woman before?
No.
Was that your first?
Yes.
And how was it, Lynn? How would you rate it on a scale of 1 to 10?
6.
6? Just a 6? Oh, you could do better neck edge, Tammy.
Well, you know, it's close mouth. It's very...
Right.
Practice.
Not very often. Exactly.
But you're intrigued by the experience right now, are you not?
Yes. Let me call up to the office and make sure the last couple is done.
Yeah. Maybe we could get a water truck in there, too.
we have two couches up there.
Yeah.
Oh. Hey.
Hey.
Hey, it's Don and Mike.
Hey.
How'd everything go up there?
Oh, very well. Thank you very much.
Everything done?
Yeah.
Okay. Did you get any paper towels in there or anything like that? Did you clean up?
Well, you know, there's a little puddle on the desk. But no.
Oh, please. Don't tell me you used the desk. Where did you guys make your glorious love?
Let's see. Floor, love seat, couch, and table.
Whoa, on our table.
We left your office chair alone, although I was extremely tempted.
Oh, goodness.
That's terrific.
All right, well.
All right.
Hope you had a great time.
Did you enjoy yourselves?
Oh, yeah.
Very good.
Elizabeth, there's one thing that I want to ask you. Somebody, not even Mike knows this, somebody that works on the show told me that you told them that it's a very special time right now in your wife's life.
Almost.
Almost?
Yeah.
Almost, or is it?
Right on the edge.
Oh. We got to buy some new couches.
God, oh,
okay.
Well, it looks like I'll be sitting Indian style for Monday.
Bloody good.
Fantastic.
Well, listen, you kids, what are you doing tonight? You guys going out?
Yep, we got a hot date tonight. We got rid of the kids overnight, so we're heading out on 10.
All right, well, enjoy.
Have a great time.
Hey, I don't suppose we can steal a couple of these cigars, huh?
Oh, knock yourself out. Look in our humidor. Pick out something
nice. Whatever you want.
Thank you very much.
Take those cushions home if you want.
And please vacate the office.
We shall.
Because the next couple is coming up.
Absolutely, and this is an overwhelming success. Wouldn't you agree, Lynn?
Yes. Okay, bye-bye, sir. Thanks.
Okay, bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Now, what we better do is hustle them out of the office and get you guys up so there's no more awkward moments between Lynn and Melanie.
Then, of course, you will enjoy total privacy.
Oh. And then, you know, you do what you want to do, and then you just come down and tell us all about it.
That's all we want. You know. But while you're doing whatever you're doing, total privacy.
Okay. How about one more kiss?
Just one little tiny kiss.
One more kiss. One more kiss. Here we go. Could I please ask just a little closer to the microphone?
They couldn't hear that anyway.
Please.
All right, here we go.
You can describe it as we're doing.
Pull the microphone right up to your face.
The microphone.
Please.
There you go.
Stanley and Lynn.
All right.
Kiss her again?
Yes, kiss her again, please.
There, Ann. Again.
Okay. All right. Oh, do you want to talk to Tammy's boyfriend?
Sure. Let's talk to Tammy's boyfriend.
He's not on the phone.
Is your boyfriend's name Rob?
No.
Oh. Did you hear that hang up? That's a member of the Beach Towel Club.
That's somebody who just wanted to get involved in the fun.
My boyfriend is listening, but I doubt he's calling into the show right now.
Would you like to say anything to Rob if he's listening right
now? His name is not Rob.
Or whatever his name is.
Yeah, no. I called him and prepped him before I even came up here. He's fully aware of what's happening.
Boy, you are one confident young woman, that is for sure.
All right,
see you like in those pageants down in Texas. Hi, how are you?
All right, come on, boys, get out of here now. Get out. Take them up to the office, please.
Have fun.
We'll call you to tell you when it's time to start. Okay?
You know, and really, they are very similar. They are very, very similar.
Yes, they are.
Yes, they are.
Yes, they are.
Woo-hoo!
Oh, mother, we'll be right back. Let me call up to the office, see if everything's done.
All right, find out.
Great experiment. Hello?
You know, they might not see that light. I reminded Tammy to watch that light ring.
Ah, there we go. Have to give them the all clear sign. All clear.
Hello?
Tammy?
No, this is Lynn.
Oh, hey, Lynn.
Lynn answering the phone.
Yeah.
Lynn, time's up.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, do you need more time?
Well, I guess we'll just have to continue this another time.
Really?
What happened?
What do you expect happened?
Did you get naked?
A little bit.
A little bit naked, huh?
Did you find out what it's like to be gay?
Some of the pleasures that can be elicited, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you found the experience pleasurable?
Yes.
Why'd you leave your boyfriend down here?
It was kind of an agreement that Tammy and I had before we came up. Mm.
He's a very sad man.
Let me talk to Tammy, please.
Okay, hold on.
Now let's talk to the man in this relationship.
Hello.
Hey, Tammy.
Hey, how are you?
So you broke her in good, huh?
Oh, I didn't break her in good, but boy, she's really cute. She's a great kisser.
Mm. What else did you do to her?
We were just kind of taking our time getting to know each other, but she's a lot more aggressive than what she acts. She acts
like
she's all shy. Yeah, she's
excellent.
Not.
Excellent. So you enjoyed yourself?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she's really cute, isn't she?
And you two are going to see each other again?
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right.
All right.
Successful experiment.
Very good. Very good. Good experiment.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, by the way.
Yes.
Y'all might want to get, some different material on these couches because your skin kind of sticks to it.
Mm. Yeah, it doesn't bother me.
That could have been left for the previous couple, Tammy. thank you for helping us out, Tammy.
Hey, thank you.
Okay. Let me talk to Lynn again.
Okay, here she is. Hi.
Hi, Lynn.
Happy day for you, Lynn.
A very happy day.
Well, listen, will you please do this? Will you let us know what happens as your lesbian side emerges?
Surely.
Like if you go out with Tammy again or you meet other girls.
Uh-huh.
Keep us posted, and you might want to show Ross a good time tonight, too.
Oh, definitely.
Let him smell your fingers. Bye now, Lynn.
Bye.
Bye-bye. And all of that happening. Mm. Right upstairs.
Upstairs, in total privacy.
In our office.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
You should have seen. I still picture that look on Ross's face. He's sitting there going, poor me. Sorry, we're out of time.
Till we meet again. This is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.